turn it over to Chris. You folks met Chris before. What I'm hoping from the board tonight, after the presentation, is that the department gets some direction on what you would like us to do. Either we can do nothing, we can look at the per bear rule, but we need that direction from you if we decide to pursue any things further. You've got our recommendations on what we support, what we oppose already, but Chris will talk in more detail. And then depending on your direction, if you have direction where you want the board to do some action on the current per bear rule to amend it, then we will regroup internally and try to drop the language working with our attorney, law enforcement people, and others. The last thing we want to have is changing one of our existing rules and not have to be enforceable or pragmatic from a management standpoint. So,
and Mark, let me just ask very briefly that if that comes to pass and we advance those recommendations, there will be additional public meetings, hearings, and comment opportunities.
Thanks for mentioning that, Lewis, because I think sometimes for many people, I think here tonight, this is probably the first time we've even been to a Fish and Wildlife Board meeting that we've had, and I can say that with pretty certainty, because I've been coming over about 6 years and haven't missed too many. But these are working meetings of the board that they hold, and they rely on the department for the data and the science. Anybody can petition the board through the petition process and they act on them. They can decide to act right away or table it or go back to the department for more information to do that. And any comments the department gets that we feel is related to a topic that the board's dealing with, we pass it on to the board. But if the board decides to take action at any time, then it opens up what Lewis is talking about as a formal public process that we have to follow by law to do that. And number of hearings that we have, where we have that, is usually dependent on the board. Sometimes it depends on the topic or the issue at hand as well. So, and why do you brought that up, Lewis? So, in knowing that everything we do is public, the meetings that we hold in our own department, we want to try to give people an opportunity to speak if they want to that's pertinent to the subject. And, there should be the sign-up sheet is still going around. Is that?
It's here if anybody's not on.
So, if you want an opportunity to speak tonight, you've got that here. So, okay. We met Chris in the most recent meeting, so I'll turn this over to Chris Bernier. So, Chris, nice work. Appreciate your cooperation and your due diligence to look very closely at all of you. So, let's give Chris a warm welcome.
For a nice succinct title for this, the words around trying to change it up, but there's no two ways about it. It's what it is. There's a lot of substance here, so it's what it is. And also, sitting here as we all did just a little while ago, watching the video that was cycling or actually just played at the beginning of the meeting, kind of dawned on me as well that I feel like we're almost victims of our own success to some degree here. When you look at the tremendous work that has been done by this board, not these individuals per se, but board, system, the department, looking at where we have been historically and where we have come to the present, it really is remarkable the amount of work has been accomplished and the bounty of these resources that we are involved in. It's a privilege to be a part of this process. Humbling, but a privilege nonetheless. And, you know, I think in saying that we're a victim of our own success, I guess I have to explain that. It's like, you know, one of the things that we do is making sure we have abundant wildlife and making sure that people have opportunities to enjoy that wildlife in whatever fashion it might be, of obviously the limitations, but hunting and fishing and trapping and wildlife watching and so on and so forth, we have to instill appreciation of these wildlife resources for everybody out there. And I think this turnout, and I have a suspicion that turnouts to come are going to actually reinforce that that is in fact the case. We've been successful with that. And so why is that a primary victim? Well, the problem is that the public appreciates these resources in a whole host of ways. I don't really need to even say these things. I think we all understand that. But it's all over the board. And that is the problem. That is what makes this so challenging, because everyone has such deep-rooted feelings, convictions, passions for these resources. So that is really the problem that I have been challenged with, is trying to work our way through this process to come to some decision with respect to these petition items that makes sense and that takes into account everyone's input. And then also what I'm watching with the introduction here, I realized, you know, this is the appropriate venue, not physically here, but the system, the process that we have, the board, the Fish and Wildlife Department, the public, the constituents that we traditionally reach out to, these issues in particular, it is a process. When you look at the tremendous successes that we have driven to today, I mean, it's powerful. This is the body and the process that makes the most sense. It would be irresponsible, I think, for us to not actually address these in this manner using this process that we have. And then, just a word about my approach, our approach specifically. Given all the challenges and the breadth of opinion and the backdrop of conversations that are going on behind all of this, there is a process by which, an approach by which, we are trying to really do our due diligence to the mission of the department, and I think to each and everyone's individual missions as they relate to the greater conservation. You know, and I think through Mark's introduction of the various people that have been involved, from law enforcement to biostatisticians to, you know, senior, not age-wise, just experiential biologists that have been in the trenches on all these issues, and then the depth and the degree to which we've looked at all this data and collected it and continue to move that forward. This is an evolution, but up to present, I don't know that we can really criticize the approach that we've had. It's been very, I think, logical. It's been as thorough as I've been able to drive with all the issues that we're going to be dealing with. And I think it's appropriate. But I blather on. Those who know me know that I get into these rants, and I apologize. We have a lot to cover. And I'll say one more thing, too, before we jump in. Sorry, how much time do we have? I think I've got maybe an hour and a half to 4 hours worth of material. The other thing, too, that if it hasn't come up, I want it to come out loud and clear, at least from my perspective right here, right now, is that I have not been able to answer every email, both pro or con, of this company, or answer every phone call, or actually have an answer for any of these things that have come my way. It's just physically impossible for me to be able to engage in the activity of doing what I need to do to get to these conclusions through this process. I can't possibly answer all of the onslaught that has resulted in. That does not mean that I don't listen and hear. I go through and I open every email that has come into my I'm sure will attest to it, those that have seen my email account. And I at least read through, particularly those that have taken the time to write something in that email other than a cookie stamp, cookie cutter, cut and paste. I mean, not that I belittle that either, but the people that have taken that time, I have digested and it has been a part of this process for me. And you know, I care about people's opinions. I understand that at the end of the day, there will be a decision. And at the end of the day, there will be some group, some individual that will be hurt by this decision, not physically necessarily, but certainly emotionally or however. And regardless of which way this goes. And that does bother me. And I struggle to deal with that. Okay, so without further ado. One of the first things I want to just address right off the top of this, and Commissioner Porter mentioned it in his introduction, is that of the Wildlife Action Plan, the status of species of greatest conservation need. And the reason why I put this up, I mean, there's been a lot of different things that have been levied against this petition. And this one I take very personal because I think it's not only a misuse of the intent of this particular document, but I was a principal player in its development. I mean, the listing of otter and bobcat in the Wildlife Action Plan came off of my desk. And so when I received an email that someone says, you should not do this because, don't you know, there are species of greatest conservation need? It's like, well, actually, I do. And I also understand why there are species of greatest conservation need. So first, you have to understand what this document is. It is a tool by which we leverage money for applying resources to species that we have discernible threats for or gaps of knowledge for. It is to address things that we can predict or things we need to be able to understand. It is a mechanism of function. It's not the status of its abundance. There are a host of species on the list. In fact, 34 of them for mammals, not to count any of those. And some of them are harvested, like bobcat, like otter, like grouse, snowshoe hare. A lot of them are common, but there are discernible threats for them. It's not the harvest, it's the threat for the long-term persistence. In fact, when you look at bobcat and otter specifically, as well as others, the information we get from the harvest of bobcat and otter in state is what ended up putting those on the list in part. There are other issues. We can collect all harvests of fisher, otter, and bobcat in state, which is a boom of opportunity for data collection. And we engaged our academic partners, and there are too many to name, but there have been many. Green Mountain College, Linden State University, I want to name many of them. All of them, UNH, a lot of different research has come out of this. And through that research, we have identified discernible threats. Genetic threats, barriers in the landscape through genetic analysis, one outcome of the otter, I just combined those two species, of the otter, of the bobcat genetic analysis. With otter, we actually used that sample that we could get to test for the bioaccumulation of heavy metals in the tissue, which we found two otter out of 20 that were sampled. This was a pilot study. Maybe we'll do some more of this, but the opportunity exists to use that as a measure of landscape toxicity or trends in changes of these things. That is power for us to be able to understand these things. Disease, surveillance, and understanding disease, epigenetics, the way our genes or the animals' genes are manifested in their behaviors. The list goes on and on. So, again, harvest is not the reason why these species are on the list. It's in part the information that we gathered from that data collected that led us to understand that they need to be on the list.
Chris?
Yes?
Can I just add that the listing of bobcats on the Wildlife Action Plan allowed us to apply state wildlife grant funds to a habitat study that we would not have been able to afford if it hadn't been listed as a species of greatest conservation.
That's right. And actually, actually, that stemmed from conversations with trappers and hunters, the bobcats, that led us to what we thought, a conclusion at that time, that there were certain habitats in the state that were critical. Rocky ledges, or rocky outcrops, certain wetlands, and so we got the information from these folks, and then had on the 2005 action plan, and then actually had the study, which helped us understand more how bobcats utilize our landscape. And there are other examples of that, too. So we'll jump into what I think is probably the easiest of the three issues that we're going to look at here tonight. There's not a lot to say about it. I'll let this speak for itself. I know that most of you probably understand at this point what a colony trap is, but I need to start there for those that don't. This is a muskrat colony trap, a cage trap. Trappers make them commonly. There are a bunch of different versions that are commercially available as well, but they all operate on the basic premise that the animal moves in, this flap here just pushes up, it's not spring loaded or anything, and it drops back down, and the animal is captured in the trap. They are actually quite selective because you can control the diameter of the opening. So that allows for selectivity of what can fit in the bag. This is the way they're typically deployed in the field. You can see there's another measure of selectivity where you deploy it, where you know you've got your target species moving through. They are set underwater. This is a kill trap. So the animals that get into this, the muskrat get into this, drown in that trap. The whole issue that we're trying to solve here really is a result our own screw up. But it's an understandable screw up when you look at the rules that regulate trapping in the state. They are complex, and they are nuanced, and they are many. Regulated trapping is the most regulated activity that the department oversees in the state. And so when we get into a rule to make a change, which we do regularly, to update the rules, depending on the issue du jour, or modernize the language or what have you, when we get in there, there's often a trickle-down effect where we make a change for a good measure, but we did not foresee what might happen beneath it. This is the example that we had here. This is the historic rule language prior to 2008. And you'll note it does not distinguish any type of trap, just that traps set underwater or ice during our beaver season must be checked every 72 hours. So in this rule, these cage traps, the colony cage traps, were allowed a 72-hour check. That is the way they've been up until 2008. At that point, in 2008, there were a number of changes that transpired there. And one of them was the recognition that foothold traps are different. Foothold trap on the water is not necessarily a kill time trap. Generally is the way it's set, but it does not have to be. So an animal in a foothold trap doesn't necessarily die unless it is set specifically to kill that animal. So there was a movement, amongst other things, that took place then, unrelated to this, to separate that out and to make the distinction that body ripping traps, which is a kill trap, regardless of where it's set, water or otherwise. But body traps in the water or foothold traps or body traps under the ice, because a foothold trap under the ice is definitely a kill trap. So there was this movement to separate those up. This 72-hour check that we're talking about is for kill type of traps, set in aquatic environments. That's what it's for. Cage traps didn't end up in there. When we separated them up and defined the body gripping traps, foothold traps, cage traps, got left off the list, an inadvertent mistake. And then, this I think was one of the first things that I got involved in a regulatory manner when I got involved in this position. And again, there was a whole other backdrop of other things we were trying to address, but I tried to get this remedy at that point, 2013, and I got closer, but I didn't quite get there. So again, body gripping traps in the water or under the ice, foothold or cage traps under the ice, but it did not address these cage traps under the water, which are definitively kill-type traps. I have to make it an admission, because being recorded by Vermont Public Radio, I stole a photo from your website, and I apologize for that. I wanted a photo of a muskrat trap, and I typed in to Google, as I think we all do, we go to the photo, and lo and behold, we got a Vermont muskrat trapper here, and lo and behold, it's the Vermont Public Radio site, and listen to it. It's called Rumble Script Vermont, and the title of the program is Muskrat Trapper, and it aired, I think, in March or sometime, I forget exactly when, but really it was a great piece that Vermont Public Radio did. At any rate, that's just the backdrop. So in summary, the adoption of this rule change by trying to fix this problem, we do not in any way anticipate any change of trapper behavior, trap type use, or increase in harvest, or even any change in the way that the animals die in these traps, because it's just a change of the check period to make it consistent with other traps set in the aquatic environments in a way that facilitates the rapid death. So there really is no biological reason, in my opinion, that this should not be moved forward.
I'm going to stop you, Chris, for a second. Is there any board member questions about that colony? I think we've got to break this down a bit. Just Justin.
Yeah, is there any grading of the fur between 48 and 72 hours?
I have done a bit of looking into that, because that has been something that's been brought up. And I can't find definitively, you know, in literature, wildlife society, journal, that there is any such thing. Again, this is a largely a winter trapping season under the ice or under the water, generally under the ice during the time it's actually out there, but cold water regardless. I don't know.
Anybody else?
Any questions there?
Thanks, Chris.
So, again, muskrat being easy, we'll move into a little bit more complex discussion. And before I get too far into it, I just want to lay the groundwork for how I'm going to present this, because that is one of my biggest challenges, is how I present this. Because there's a lot of information. There's a lot of analysis done, some of which the methodology of the analysis I'm very new to, so I'm learning those things. Fortunately, I have an incredible team that's going to assemble to help with these things. You all have a copy of the report that I put together, the assessment report, and I think for 3 weeks now I've had it. So rather than try to go through it all, I chose from that the things that I felt were really the most influential in making our decision or making our recommendation. And I'm not going to get into, for me to be here all night, if I did, I'm not going to get into fine detail unless you want to and I'm asked to, the nitty gritty of the analysis. But also understanding that, that this has been a bit like drinking from the proverbial fire hose to try to get to this point, I would ask the second, I think Mark is the one that said it, that those that have been involved in this process to please jump in as necessary. If you feel like I am not portraying it accurately, or you can add to it, that makes it more understandable. So please feel free. So before you get into the conversation of the bobcat season extension, I think you have to understand a little bit of what's driving this, because it is important. The department's rules, in large part, tracking regulations in large part, are designed both temporally for time, but also the design of the trap types that allow here and there to target suites of species. So your foothold trap in November would be used for hogs, coyotes. Not necessarily just guide, although trappers can, if they choose, target by doing certain things that that trap is set, whether it be bait, whether it be pan tension, placement. But the point is that because you can trap that species, either species in that set, those seasons are concurrent. There are several examples of that, and we're going to talk about two of them tonight, the bobcat and fisher seasons, and the otter and bobcat, or otter and beaver seasons. With respect to the bobcat and the fisher, it has been our intent all along to keep those seasons concurrent. In fact, I think the long history, and I've detailed it a little bit better than I will now, the assessment report, which, by the way, I think will be available on the department website. Is that correct? That's in the first.
It is already
in the property. For those that don't have access to it here tonight, I apologize. Please understand you can get it readily on the property. So, I lost my train of thought there. Oh, fisher in the bobcat seasons. This has been our objective all along to keep them concurrent, because the trap type used for fisher is commonly used for bobcat. They are the sweetest species. So those seasons ran concurrent right up until 2004, where the department recognized the burgeoning fisher population, which I don't know, we need to go into detail on that, but there were concerns at the time for its impact, its ability to impact other resources, marten being a prime example. And even to some extent, I think bobcat was part of the discussion. In recognition that the species are competitors, and actually the fisher is a predator in addition to competition. And the fisher population was, by all of our measures and our ability to discern it, rapidly rising. And we even thought at the time to the detriment of a very intensive marten reintroduction effort. So at that point, 2004, we moved forward on a season expansion for fisher to include a whole month of the summer, but at that time we exercised caution with bobcat. We didn't have the same data available. You're talking about much fewer animals harvested, so much fewer animals means less data. And we didn't have as high a confidence of what additional harvest bobcat at the time might mean for the population. So at that point, 2004, we now have trap sets for fisher, which could potentially be catching cats. And we're going to go into this in a little bit greater detail. This is the backdrop. What I think is driving this petition item, and this is something that has
come out in a lot of the emails and forum conversations is that people think that it was about expanding opportunities solely to catch more fish. And actually, I believe, based on conversations with lots of trappers, that really, I think the underlying motive here was the rental season's concurrent in recognition of an abundant bobcat population, which we have, to be clear, an abundant bobcat population. But they wanted more to do away with the potential for any opportunity, any chance that a bobcat could be taken in the last half of December. For one, for a variety of reasons there. And also, wanted to maximize the utilization of that resource. When a bobcat is taken in the last half of December, they have to forfeit that estate. So it's a utilization issue. So it's about reducing the potential for the harvest of that species out of season and maximizing utilization in the appearance of an abundant population. It makes sense to move that forward. We're going to parse this out, Greg. And before we get too deep into the data part of it, I think I struggled with whether this was worth, you know, addressing here or presenting here or not, but hopefully it succumbs to my long-winded nature. I wanted to give a little bit of historical context to what we're dealing with here. This is a busy graph of sorts, and things I'd like to point out on it is that, you know, this is just relative abundance. This is not numbers. These lines don't represent numbers. It's schematic to help people understand changes over time, dating back to pre-European settlement. If you look at bobcat populations, which is the red line here, back in pre-European settlement, they were actually fairly low. We had abundance of competing carnivores, predators, bulls, mountain lions, lynx, and a few. We also had much colder temperatures, with bobcat being at the northern extent of their range. Like deep, fluffy snow, cold temperatures. So I think it's very reasonable to expect that we had fairly low populations, relatively low. We also had an almost entirely forested environment, which bobcats certainly made use of the forest. I mean, you gotta understand, this is the most widely distributed land mammal in North America, or if not the, very close to the most widely distributed land mammal in North America. It occupies all habitats shy of boreal forests, and some of the transitional forests across the northern tier. But they, you know, the forested landscapes aren't necessarily the perfect habitat for optimum population size. And as we decimated our forests, converted them to ag land, and then eradicated the bull, mountain lion, so on and so forth, we actually were doing that for the favor of bobcat, apparently, here. And then looking at more modern, getting closer to more modern times, there are a couple of key changes here. One of the things is, of course, we had farm abandonment, the Industrial Revolution, was farm fields, 80% of the state was ag land at some point. The farm fields were left fallow, they grew up in the early successional habitat, there were no predators. Bobcat persisted through this whole period, despite serious persecution, you might add. But the ideal habitat for this cat came about in this period. We had white-tailed deer numbers, I'm a little reluctant to say this, but we had a lot of white-tailed deer. How's that? No predators, snowshoe dam, early successional habitat, scrub shrub, we know bobcats, all that stuff. But things change. Of course, we began to grow. We had coyotes move in. We reintroduced fisher. Things change. The bobcat population responded accordingly. Looking at the bounty, I find this fascinating. I dug this up out of an old report in the office. And this is both New Hampshire and Vermont from 1937 to 1972, which is when the bounty was ended here. Well, it actually was ended, I think, in 1971.
Yeah, this is during that period where there was, you know, we kind of tipped the balance a little bit there with respect to habitat population. 400 animals by bounty. This is any bounty. Right down to 71, where you're still looking at 200, better than 200 animals per year. And if bobcat persisted through this. And looking at contemporary management, as I said earlier in my introduction to this particular topic, that we have tried to keep these, well, this doesn't have any fisher, I took that off, sorry. But looking at contemporary management, you can see that it has been fairly conservative harvest comparatively to an all-out bounty just a decade earlier, essentially. A 7-day trapping season, 16-day hunting, 12-day trapping, 29-day hunting, and this is where we are now since 1996 for bobcats. There are a few key timeline things here. And it's also important to note that this line here does not represent any sort of population estimate or anything like the previous graph. This is harvest numbers. Just pointing out, trying to make the point that this conservative system here, there's a lot of variables that play into this, but it has worked. I mean, there are plenty of bobcats out there. One of the most recent newcomers to the scene, I hear this from more and more people, that bow hunters routinely report being stalked by bobcats. I don't know how many have heard that before. Few? It's something that I hear a fair amount about. And you know, of course, we have a pretty good turkey population in the statewide as well, and I feel pretty strongly suggest that that also has been a significant benefit. Bobcat has been a significant benefit of turkeys. And we're going to get into the nitty-gritty now. So I apologize for the text on this. That wasn't the way I had it. It's too small to read. But this is the way that we chose to aggregate the data for bobcat. Harvest data, effort data, so on and so forth. And we have traditionally aggregated our data by wildlife management units, which are smaller than these. There are, again, how many wildlife management units, but a number of quite more than the biophysical regions, which is what this is here. And that was done for a variety of reasons. Number one, these are the biophysical regions. So if there are subpopulations of bobcats in the state, it would make sense that they are operating more in this framework than a smaller wildlife management unit, if that makes sense. But also, it gives us the ability to aggregate larger amounts of data, because that's one of the limitations. You don't get a lot of data from bobcats. So, at any rate, you'll see this. I want to talk about biophysical regions or regions in the coming slides. And just to run down, this is the Taconics. I lumped this Vermont Valley, that light blue, into the Taconic region. So that is now considered one region for the purposes of this analysis. The Champlain Valley, very long. Obviously, the Champlain Valley. This is the Champlain Hills. Northern Green Mountains, Southern Green Mountains, Southern Vermont Piedmont, Northern Vermont Piedmont, and Northeast Highlands. I don't expect you to remember that, but maybe you'll. So here we go, into some data. And I'm going to try to breeze through this. Hopefully the nuance will come up in questions later. So since 2004, is that right?
Yeah,
since 2004, this is the distribution of the progression of harvest through the current 16-day season of bobcats. Don't be confused by these numbers down here. This is Julian date, so this is December 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th, all the 16th. It's just I actually had a change in the PowerPoint presentation talking, but and this is the total number of cats trapped. You can see there's a pretty distinct decline through the 16-day season in the number of cats trapped. And so the temptation is to run that out and predict out here how many additional cats would be trapped as a result of season expansion. And logically, you might think that that would be out there, not too many. But we're going to go through some of the reasons why I don't have confidence in being able to predict with any certainty what the bobcat harvest would be out present. And as an example here, we're going to look at another biophysical region. This is bobcat harvest in the northern Vermont Piedmont. Then that's the area between the Northeast Kingdom or the Northeast Highlands and the North Green Mountains. It's a large biophysical region. Actually, we're in it right now, I believe. This graph is interpreted by looking at hunting, is represented by blue, trapping is green. And the point I'm trying to make by putting this up is that one of the variables here is that trappers actually respond to pelt prices, which I think is what drove this increase here in harvest in this biophysical region. We had a spike in bobcat pelt prices in 2002 and 2013. It's logical to assume that these trappers responded to that. It's important to note, because at glance this may seem alarming, but we're talking very low numbers for a massive biophysical region. Right down here, you know, less than five up through 2011 for trapping, I'm talking about. You know, and then it jumps up to whatever that might be, 17 there at its highest. So it's, I'm not trying to put this up, set up an alarm that this is bad, but I'm trying to make the point that there is a response. Trappers have the ability to increase their harvest fairly rapidly in short order. And in this case, you know, tripling of that harvest. Looking at another biophysical region, same sort of thing. 2012-2013, fairly substantial spike. And again, this is the northern Green Mountains, the biophysical region right next door to the west here. And again, these numbers are fairly small. Two cats, the northern Green Mountains, up through that area, trapping other than this spike here. And again, another spike.
Excuse me, Chris. On those years where there's a lot of trapping done, do you have any weather data?
Yeah, that's not something that I put into this presentation, but it is something that I analyzed. And this is what I found. Number one, this is based on lots of conversations with lots of people, but I think weather conditions definitely affects trapping, obviously, crusty snow conditions, so on and so forth. Trap function primarily, and access to some degree as well. But the only data set that I had readily available to try to run any sort of analysis on that was our winter severity index, which is as good a data set as it is. It doesn't have that fine scale nuance that you would need to really detect trends. But I ran through the process, and I found no trends related to winter severity index. And for those that don't know, winter severity index is a system by which we collect data across the strait, across the state per biophysical region. And at a winter severity index point is when the snow depths are at or greater than 18 inches deep and the temperatures are at or below zero. So that gets a point. Those points are summed up over the course of the month for that biophysical region, and there's multiple points in each biophysical region. It's great data. We rely on it for a whole host of management decisions, but with respect to trying to link it to trapping, couldn't do it statistically, but intuitively I understand that that does play a part of influencing harvest. But when conditions are favorable, both in terms of prices and weather, I mean, you know, we can see dramatic spikes. And again, I'm not trying to set up an alarm here, but this is okay. It's just making the point that there is some, it hampers my ability to predict what might happen if we extend that season out for 2 weeks. The other compounding factor here is that harvest is not distributed evenly across the state, which makes sense, right? The bobcat populations aren't distributed out evenly across the state, and trappers aren't either. And so when you look at this, there's a couple things I want to point out. This is harvest density. So we typically look at harvest numbers. This is the harvest numbers
that have been put to the land area in these wildlife, in these biophysical regions. It's a better way of looking at harvest data because it equalizes the differences in the biophysical regions with respect to size. So when we look at that, you can see here, this is, I also should point out, this is trapping and hunting combined data. Is that right?
Yes, it is.
So you see, and I apologize for the difficulty of being able to read this clearly, but really the point I'm trying to make, if you don't need to be able to understand it down below, it's just that we have biophysical regions where we have different trends in harvest than we do in other places in the state. This is the conics, this brown line here, this oh, that is, but this line here is the Champlain Valley, so those in the northeast highlands, the northeast corner, those are the three that stand out.
Chris, just a question, just real quick, because you might want to quickly mention that the you're looking at bobcat harvest density, so it's a harvest per area.
Per area.
And so it's accounting, in this case, for the different sizes of the geophysical zone, so it's standardizing. So what you're looking at is really where the bobcats are coming from, not just because one geophysical zone is larger than another.
That's correct. Thank you. Again, the take-home point is that it's not equally distributed across the landscape. And so it just adds to our inability to be able to predict and be certain what might happen. Then, add on to that, again, as a demonstration that some of this is learning here a little bit. I probably should not have shown the trend line right through the whole thing like that, but for better or for worse, that's what it is here. And you know, based on this, it's pretty clear that there are increasing harvests. This is the number of specific trappers, the red line, and that's over here for numbers. And this is the number of individual bobcats on average that each traveler harvests. And the point here is that you're seeing increased harvest both in terms of the numbers of people harvesting them as well as the numbers that they are individually capturing. Again, not alarmist, but this is an increasing trend. This impacts my decision on what we do with a season expansion. We are seeing increasing opportunities without expanding this season, based on this. And then similarly, so as not to focus solely on the trapping, because you have to remember that there's a whole other season up here to hunt. And this is the same data for hunters, the same analysis for hunters. And again, you can see that there's clearly been increasing trends for both the numbers of hunters and successfully harvesting bobcats, and a slight increase, but an increasing trend in the number of individual cats in China State. So I guess in that same vein of looking at hunters and trappers increasing rates of harvest, the other complicating factor here is that the hunter harvest is not equally on the land either. Sometimes they align with trapper harvest and sometimes they don't. But in this case, in Champlain Valley, the trapper harvest number of bobcats has increased, but quite modestly. Hunters have substantially increased in the Champlain Valley, and that's actually driving part of that harvest density that we looked at in two slides earlier in the Champlain Valley. Conversely, in the southern, I think this was called Lingless Connecticut River Valley, or southern Vermont Piedmont, that's the Connecticut River Valley, the southern Connecticut River Valley. Trappers have contributed to the increased harvest as opposed to hunters there. The point is that there's a lot of variables that play into this, make it difficult for us to predict with any certainty what would happen with two expansions of bobcats. So
up to this point, we talked about harvest numbers and trends. And all this is all very useful for helping us understand what's happening out there. It's only part of the equation, and this is a key point. You have to take into account the amount of effort that people are spending. Because the numbers of animals harvested is only part of the equation. It only tells you so much. The effort that is applied that results in that harvest is really what you need. And for bobcats, we collect that harvest number, or the effort, or through trap and mail surveys, which is a voluntary trap and mail survey that was implemented in 1986. And this is a response rate graph. And you can see that it has definitely dropped off. And we have tried to get this back up with the VTA, the Vermont Trappers Association, has undertaken some different things to try and get that back up. We, the Department of Fish and Wildlife as well, and there are other things that maybe we can do in this respect. But when you're talking about an animal that only ends up with, say, 55, 60 animals trapped per year, that's on average, and you get a 30% return rate, you're only talking about data for effort on like 20 animals. And to try to apply that per biophysical region, much less the whole state, is impossible. And without effort data, we are not operating blind by any stretch, but we are more limited by our ability to predict what's going on, to explain what's going on, what's driving the harvest. The catch per unit of effort is a key piece to help us understand all these earlier graphs of what really is driving it. So, there was a lot of analysis that, I didn't put in here. I think I said that early on because it wasn't driving what I thought to be the recommendation. It wasn't, the key points. But there were, in our effort to try to trend certain harvest parameters like sex and age, biophysical region, any sort of changes in the sex and age ratios, the proportions of females in the harvest, for example, there were a couple of things that came up. And again, these aren't alarmists, not saying to be alarmists, because really when you look at the raw data that underlies it, especially in the early part of the data set when we had very little bobcats, and you saw the graph of harvest back in the 80s, very few cats. Lower sample size, you have greater variability, and greater variability in the data leads to uncertainty. But there were two trends that I will mention that are worth noting. In the southern Green Mountains, there was a slight decline. There was a negative serial correlation to the harvest 1 year with the harvest 2 years after, which in my way of describing this, that means that a high harvest year one would result in a low harvest in year three. And vice versa, low harvest in year one would result in a high harvest in year three. And why is that of any significance? Only because those sort of correlations where they exist could indicate that harvest is actually starting to change population demographics or size or what have you. Is that fair?
Yeah, it's great. The thing is, the fact that it only occurred in one area and that it's a time lag of 2 years,
right,
which is not implausible, but it's just should make you want to look a little closer, but it's really nothing that I would say is a flag of anything, other than it gives you a sense that maybe there's something that might want to look a little closer. But it could be spurious, because there is a spurious correlation.
And this is in the assessment, and I did not, one of my reasons for putting it on here is because I don't feel like I described it or explained it well in my assessment report. So the reader would probably take away from that some inferences that may not be accurate. So I wanted to address it. The other is, and I find this fascinating, because I don't know which guy is certain, but I have some pretty good ideas. The southern Mahima, the Connecticut River Valley, there was a very slight decline in the proportion of females in the harvest. Again, this is an age structure that we follow very closely over time, because that's indicating changes in your population structure, potentially caused by harvest, but maybe not by harvest. There are other things. And in this case, there was a researcher in UNH, a PhD candidate, Rory Carroll, who had come to Vermont to our necropsy sessions where we were working through the bobcats. For several years now, he's accumulated a lot of data on this. And through his genetic analysis, has determined, and this is not how peer review yet, it's all preliminary results, but I think it's interesting that he's documented that New Hampshire is a net exporter of bobcats into Vermont. And what gender are the ones that disperse bobcats to the males? And if we have a lot of males coming out of this region, which we know they do, come into Vermont, then we are logically going to be harvesting more males in that biophysical region, and thereby driving a decline in the female proportion, not as a result of harvest, but as a result of immigration from the non-harvested population that's exporting a lot of animals across the
country. This is a question over here.
Yeah. 2012 to 2014, bobcat harvest seemed to be going down, and then it bounced up 2015. Is any of that market-related? The furs, like there's a lot of bobcats taken in 2012 that would depress the fur prices, which would keep trappers out of the woods in 2013-14.
So yes, the answer is that is entirely possible. In fact, I would say that it was probable that there was some market drive. I mean, there's a lot of things that drive this. It's not all market related by any stretch, but that certainly plays into it. And you'll find in the assessment that you have to have that there. I forget the page number, but it would be I'm sorry. I did not include that in that. That's a there is actually early part. Sorry, my female law maybe. Yes, it is. So, page 17, top graph. I'll hold it up. I know this is going to be impossible to see for folks, but this line here is your bobcat harvest. This green line beneath it is the average price per pet reported to the trapping hospital. And they are for it. I wouldn't say that it was a particularly strong correlation. Actually, it is a particularly strong correlation, but they are more. And again, there are a lot of factors that affect that.
Anyone else? Any other questions, board members?
Hey, I think some seats have opened up in here if folks would like to have a chance.
So, this is one that I got here. Struggled a bit because I am always asked by everybody, what's the population? What's the population? You don't know what you're doing if you don't have the population estimate. And I addressed it fairly well, I think, in the assessment report, why we don't have a population estimate perfectly. But what we do have is the ability to model things using different models, in this case, the downwind model, to help inform us with what's going on in those populations. This is not a population, the population of the bobcats in the state, clearly. What it is the Downey model follows an age cohort through time. So in year one, all your zeros, 0 to 1 year olds, are added up. And then in year two, your 1 to 2 year olds are added
to the 0 to 1s a year before, because they're the same age class. That's the age cohort. As it works its way through time, every year we're sampling a little bit more of that same age class. And at the end, you can add all those up by adding it through your age matrix, and you can get the population back in year one on those cats. That makes sense. This is your harvested population. This is basically doing that for you, adding all that together, and showing you the harvested population. But again, it's not a population estimate. It's just another tool. And I won't spend a lot of time on it because it is in the assessment report, but population estimates are not easy to come by. Anyone who thinks otherwise doesn't understand the realities of trying to get out there and do this work. I think Jackie's presentation earlier today, which I don't even think that's in the scope of your office, not even at all, and we're not going to find money. These are very difficult things to get at. I will say, with respect to population estimates, what I anticipate to do is to get estimates from other indices that help add to this. So one of the things that's come of late with our lynx work in the Northeast Kingdom and the farm work in the southern Vermont are cameras. We've got cameras set up all over the place. That is awesome data. Actually, Jackie has a lot of cameras you heard about as well. So we're pooling that data. And there are, this is a sample. So now you can find out how many cats, you know, are coming into your cameras, compared to your harvest or your this model or what have you. But we're at the beginning stage, at least with the camera work in that regard. Yes.
I think to bring these up a little about the downy market, those numbers on the y-axis there, that is an absolute minimum estimate of the population. And it is probably grossly underestimating it simply because it assumes that every animal in that population is eventually killed by the trap as it's harvested in some way. And of course, we all know that is not the case. And so it's a gross underestimation. The only value is the trend. So in other words, don't even bother even looking at the values of the numbers. Just look at the directions of the lines.
So we need to move on to otters. There's a lot more coming. So in summary here, the department's recommendations were largely based on the fact that it's difficult for us to predict with any certainty what's going to happen if you essentially double the volume. Too many variables. Secondly, we have increasing trends in harvest already without increasing the trap and sleep. And third, you know, in the fact of being conservative, we are ensuring that there, to the best of our ability, that there is a technical opportunity for public appreciation or utilization interactions with the species as well. There's hunters, non-consumptive public, and trappers, and too many things involved with respect to, too many variables involved with respect to trying to predict with any certainty what happened. That is being conservative. There are other issues. I don't think they're big issues with respect to the, you know, the portion of females. I think that's very easily explainable, but we need to do some work on that. And there are, that's essentially what I'm getting at.
Any board questions?
Actually, the other thing.
Are there going to be board questions about bobcats or? Great. Gonna let them close and move on.
So well, department's recommendation is not extending
bobcats. I'm sorry. I had a mental block. If I could just finish.
Sure, Chris. Thank you.
I'm almost done with this. But one of the other issues is just the data that we have. You know, if we don't have, without engaging our houndsmen and our bobcat hunters to get their effort data in some form or fashion, as well as the trap and nail surveys, we need that data
to understand all these trends for the sake of making a recommendation that is appropriate. It's small bite.
Thank you. Yeah. Are there other questions, folks? I obviously we'll have more time as time goes on here, but anything specific? I guess you're lucky you've had a lot of this information for a week or so. But.
I have a question.
Thank you.
At the end of your conclusion and bobcat analysis, you talk about influences on the bobcat population. What exactly are those influences that you're finding?
I've been following through a lot of stuff and other deadlines to write things and get it out there, and I don't believe that I did what I was intending to do justice. I was trying to basically summarize the two trends that I pointed out in the southern Vermont Piedmont and the southern Vermont, as those are some indexes that would indicate that there's something going on. And out of abundance of caution, we vet that, get the data, whether it be the effort data or additional genetic work that our partners are coming to answer them. But that's essentially what that was. It didn't necessarily come out that way, I realize, but that's what it was. Did that answer your question?
That's the only influence at this time?
I think that's pretty fair to say, yes.
Okay.
We all set, folks?
Thanks, Chris. Let's move on.
All right. So, next up is river otter. And again, this is a lot of stuff here. I can't put it all in, save the time. So I'm focusing on the key things that led to our decision. But I want to point out before I get into it too far, again, just a little bit of context for how this came to be. It's very similar to the bobcat, and that's a suite of species that have traditionally been open for trapping during the same season. That makes sense. Because an otter and a beaver can be caught using the same traps. There are ways to make them selective, the way to place them, where to place them, so on and so forth, that you will catch one from the trap set or another, despite being set illegally and properly. So, the history is in the assessment report here, but in a nutshell, we have always run these seasons concurrent until 2007 in response to burgeoning beaver complaints that were coming in. This goes back, there have been ending up lots of beaver issues. And we wanted to give the trappers an opportunity to harvest more beaver in season when they can be utilized versus out of season when they aren't utilized because of health findings. And to be clear, that happens, as we all know. So the initiative at the time, 2007, was to expand the beaver season specifically, not the otter season at that time. But then, for the first time in Vermont's history, we had this opportunity for otter, albeit very few numbers, we're going to go through this to be caught, some get caught in beaver traps in March. So what's driving this petition is very similar to the bobcat. It's again a desire amongst trappers. They don't want to take anything out of season for a host of reasons. Again, utilization of the resource, the carcass is seized, forfeited, whatever you want to call it, by the law. But also in the climate that we're in right now, the social climate that we're in, people who don't necessarily understand the context of trapping seize upon these opportunities when there is one bobcat taken in the month of March on 2012 to use that to demonstrate that no traps are selected. all of them, there's some danger.
Oh, it's not otter. You're still on bobcat.
It's a challenge.
I know.
You're out for it. Yeah, the point is that trappers don't want to catch anything out of season. In a large part, they're very, very, very successful. And also, similar to bobcat, the request is driven by their knowledge that these are abundant resources. There's a lot of otter out there. And so it makes sense. And then I think also they understand and share our objective in trying to minimize out-of-season harvest of beaver as well. And the likelihood that incidentally taking otter to nuisance beaver traps, you know, that's possible. Let me just get into this more, because I spend more time explaining. First, I think you need to just take a peek at the nature of beaver and otter. When we talk about the management of one, we are talking about the management of the other. They are intertwined, both in terms of the habitats they occupy and sometimes their behavior. They are intertwined. So you can't divorce them. Historically, just going back briefly back in time, in the 1600s, pre-European settlement, we decimated the beaver population. I think everybody here recognizes that, understands that. Right? 1670, I think, over a quarter of a million beaver were shipped out on the Connecticut River alone. That's substantial. By the time the wagon trains were making their way out west, there were no beaver here. And with that liquidation of that wildlife resource, we saw declines in all these other species which rely on beaver. They are keystone species which create habitat. I'm going to hammer this one again and again, because this is not about any hatred for beaver. I recognize their incredible value ecologically. But moose, ducks of all types, waterfowl of all types. And the other thing is the cycle of beaver on landscape that really is impressive. Where they occupy their habitat, they eat themselves out of house and home, bend the site, that site drains out, becomes a very plush, wet meadow, it regenerates to this, early successional, the beaver move back in. That cycle of their disturbance on the landscape is incredible. It's a boon for all types of wildlife. In fact, plants, even insects. We have a new wildlife management area in southern Vermont called Turner Hill Wildlife Management Area that was specifically purchased for the protection of beaver so that a federally endangered plant could subsist there, which is reliant on the cycle of beaver to prosper. The point here is that otter, are a part of this habitat. In Maine, back in the, I think it was the late 80s, there was a research project that was done in Mount Desert Island where they were trying to figure out in other parts of the state why, what was driving the absence or presence of beef, put it simply. And they tested 39 variables of the landscape, stream lengths, shoreline roughness, and on distance to human infrastructure, 39 variables in the landscape. And the one that predicted the occurrence of otter by a long shot was the presence of active beaver. And the one that predicted the presence of otter by the second measure was the presence of inactive beaver habitats. So very clear, this animal, otter, relies on beaver. And when you look at the history of beaver in the state, I think it's fair to say that our population has tracked the beaver population to the present. Do you not say that's fair? So they're engineers of the landscape, as we all recognize. And there's some fun facts buried in here that I'd love to talk about. Lars Wilson is a zoologist way back in the day from Sweden. I think this was the late 60s, early 70s. He had captive beaver. He had several kits that were isolated from parents, kept in captivity, isolated from any other adults from birth to the study. And he put them in a dry concrete tank with a recorder of the sound of water, and there were a bunch of sticks and stones and just odds and ends in that tank. And those two beaver built a dam using that stuff. No water, but they built a dam around the recorder. Juveniles. And the other thing he found is that these same kits that are have been isolated from adults, built in an actual environment outside, actually built dams as well as any adult could build. So this is an innate quality of beaver. They build dams. That is what they use for creating this incredible diversity on the landscape. And the department, again, recognized that way back then. You know, we've lost our population, unregulated take, habitat destruction, so on and so forth. But early on in our history, we recognized that beaver were a keystone species, and without that, we weren't going to be able to restore some of the populations. So in 1920, I think it was 21, we began a trap and truck project where we had beaver from New York and Maine, a small number, brought down to Bennington County, where they prospered, and as they prospered, we trapped and relocated their offspring to other parts of the state. We went through to 1937, I believe. And I think it's kind of cool here is that in 1941, I believe it was, 1941, the department undertook a survey of the beaver population. So this is 4 years after the last introduction, the last trapping truck. And they determined that there were 400 beavers. This is based on active beaver colony counts. They determined that there were 400 beaver in the state, in most counties, not all counties at that time. Then, again in 1944, they repeated that same survey methodology. 3 years later, there were 1,100 beaver. And then in 1949, they repeated it again, same methodology, there were 8,000 beaver. Again, there was a different environment back then. They didn't have, different landscape, different ensemble of animals. But still, the point is, these animals prospered. By 1950, yeah. So this is a year after the last survey. A year after the last survey, where 8,000 were documented in 1949, the beaver complaints were all new. Already at that point. And so the department kicked off its first ever modern regulated harvest of beaver. 15-day season. During that first 15-day season, they harvested 1,100 beaver, which was the population estimate in 1944, 6 years prior. I say that because it's remarkable. It's a remarkable animal in all respects. High fecundity. Pretty impressive. So, yes, it's all good. We love beaver. We want them on our landscape. We don't tend to keep them here and manage them appropriately for that purpose. But, you know, there's a lot of issues with beaver. They have caused innumerable issues for private landowners, roads. I don't want to harp on that too much, but we all get that. You don't have to travel far to see beavers and causing issues. Part of that, I think, is because of our history here, right? Our infrastructure was largely built in a beaver-free environment. So this is our fault. We get this. not fish or wildlife, but humans. And we had no beaver lines. The vast majority of our roads were put in. Every road in the city of Vermont is right beside a stream in Texas about reference, exactly where it should be if you want to avoid beaver issues. But that is where it is. And when we talk about infrastructure, I'm not talking about agricultural issues or, you know, private landowners, and all of the variety of issues that beavers create for them. Look at just the state of Vermont and the roads that they maintain. There's 64,000 culverts under the maintenance regime of beavers. There's 14,000 plus miles of state highway, not including municipal roads, not including private driveways. And it's incredible. You know, we've created the perfect storm here. So, what do we do? Well, you know, in recognition that there, you know, this is a resource that we don't want to turn into a nuisance species. That's what we don't want to do. We want to maintain public perception of things as positive, as desired on the landscape. That we lose public perception for these species. Our ability to manage them effectively is diminished greatly. So we go to great extents to work to try to resolve beaver problems. In fact, the department, it was in the assessment report, invested $37,000 direct technical assistance to beaver alone. And to put that in perspective, that's about 20, maybe 25% of my third area budget, which covers 17 species, including federally listed, state listed, 13 harvested by trap and 6 harvested by hunting. So 20% plus of my budget goes to resolving beaver problems. Our staff that we bring on, seasonal staff, to deal with this, respond to an excess of 100 calls or emails a year complaining to beaver. We do an excess of 50 site visits a year. This is time and money to get out there, and it's a lot of education. It's a lot about, oh, this is what you could do, this is what you could do, you know. It's overwhelming. We've invested a lot of time into trying to maintain beaver and to help resolve problems in a peaceable manner. And here's some results to that effect. And since 2000, we've installed over 291 control structures statewide. Control structures are baffles, deceivers, there's a variety of ways people refer to them in the past, but they're essentially devices that you can install that help to mitigate flooding, that help us be able to control the water level and not the beaver to mitigate flooding issues. And fences, exclusion fences, mostly from culverts, but a whole bunch of other things too, the fence from time to time. Despite this effort, still today, based on our trapper mail survey, we are able to determine that on average, our annual beaver harvest is approximately 35%, consists of approximately 35% of nuisance animals taken out of season. Despite this effort. And there are private citizens that also offer these services to citizens as well. So it's not just us doing it. We're still not getting to where we want to be. That's a high number. And you can complicate it further is the way that the regulatory nature works here. This is controlled by the statute. The nuisance, we've got the nuisance rule, it's in statute. And it really inhibits us from being able to collect the data on what's happening outside of the season. We can collect a lot of data from licensed trappers in the season, but what's happening outside the season, it's hard for us to really follow. And we have to use what data sources we have. I'll leave it at that. So we do rely on trapping. I mean, and here's why. I mean, this is cannot be ignored as a viable tool in managing beaver.
obviously we're not going to battle our way out of this. We can't. It's not the one-size-fits-all solution. This is all hands on deck. I mean, trapping is an effective tool for helping us manage this population. It is important to understand. And this is why. Trappers have to have landowner permission. They need access as well. They're not lugging their equipment deep into the woods. You know, they are going to have access. And they're going to landowners that are given permission, which farmers are a big one, because they're the ones struggling here. The point is that the harvest of beaver through these regulations and through this season structure is largely targeting that portion of the population that is most subject to causing problems. Does that make sense?
No.
But why is that true?
Yeah. Why is it true?
Yeah.
Well, if you have to set a trap, you're walking in a quarter mile, half a mile, and you've got to check that trap in accordance with the rules, and then if you catch a beaver, you've got to lug it out. And people do that. I'm not trying to suggest that it does not happen. I'm just suggesting that on the whole, trappers are targeting those portions of the population, beaver population, that are the most accessible, which are the ones that are the most likely to cause problems, and where they have access to by landowner permission. I mean, again, it's not one size fits all. I don't mean to suggest that all trapping is taking place in this spot. Trap beaver in the woods. The majority of them, pretty clearly, is in these test areas. I think I need to hustle. No, I'm getting some tired notes here.
Yeah.
This is my opportunity to try to get these points across. And, these are big issues. These are a lot of people with a lot of opinion on these matters. And I want to make sure that we do like justice to this issue. So in 2007, another part of the problem here, in 2007 when the beaver season was expanded, we also implemented some certain rules that would help to minimize the likelihood that otters would be taken in the beaver trap setting. We referred to those as the trigger rules. And these were based on a design that was tested in New York and I think also in Tennessee, and that met with quite a bit of success in reducing reducing otter capture in these traps. And essentially it's a system of moving triggers to one side, requires a certain size trap, and the configuration of the trigger itself, and so on and so forth. We won't get into those weeds. And I think it worked largely. I think here in Vermont, when we did that, I think you know we did not see a big spike when the seasons diverged. We did not see a spike in incidental otter harvest during March. It didn't happen. So clearly, this helped. And the problem here is that it works, but it also interferes with proper trap function when you monkey around with it. And it allows animals to get further into the trap. What you're trying to do is allow otter to pass through completely. And a large part they do. Occasionally one gets into there. And it sets the trap off later than it was designed to set off. It interferes with the proper trap function. And that results in a situation where the animal does not die as rapidly as the trap was designed to kill it. So that's a welfare issue that is needed to address. Trappers have not many, but a few. I pointed that out, and you know, I think it's our objective here to try to address that. I wanted to point out something too here, the two middle bullets, is that prior to the season expansion in March, beaver, here, 44% of beaver were taken in defensive property. That's outside of the season. So prior to us expanding the season, and then after the season expansion into March, we saw a decline of 28%. There's a lot of variance here, but those are the numbers. So I read that as, well, that season expansion in March actually worked. That was the design objective, was to reduce the amount of beaver taken out of season. And also, because we can reduce the amount of beaver taken out of season, which is happening by anybody, we are logically also reducing the likelihood that otter will be taken out of season, incidental nuisance will be addressed as well. All right, we're going to just go through some of the data on which we relied for our recommendations. Again, similar to the biophysical region map that we put up earlier, this is a watershed management unit map. That's the scale at which we collect our data and assess it and aggregate it for cost. So here's just straight up otter harvest from 1980 to present. What I would consider to be essentially stable, increased a little bit. It varies on a whole host of factors, but over the long haul, it's maybe increasing a little bit. I'm not doing this trend in any way. It's similar to bobcat, the harvest isn't distributed all over, evenly across the landscape. So that slight increase that you see in the overall state harvest is largely being driven by these increases here in WSMU3, which is, that's the Champlain Valley. I take that back. I didn't bog that confused with biophysical region. I apologize. A lot of numbers here. WSMU3 is the Otter Creek, Captain Dane, Little Otter Creek, and Lewis Creek in the chain. So that's, if you remove WSMU3 from the harvest over that period of time, there is no trend at all. So, similar to the bobcat, we put the otter harvest to a density. And for otter, it's widely reported as river run, otter taken per river run. That's the measure of density. And so when we do that, the harvest that we saw, the increased harvest of WSMU3, disappears completely here. And that indicates that, well, it's a large watershed, for one, a large watershed management unit with a lot of water resources. And so when there's a spike in the harvest like that, it's just such a big area that the harvest density doesn't respond like it does in smaller units. So it disappears. And then these others, when we look at this as a measure of density, these others rise to the top. And WSMU 12, WSMU 2, WSMU 13, of those that really rise to the top. And that may seem alarming. Like, why would you keep them more there than anywhere else? Well, this is a function. It took me a while to parse this out. This is clearly a function of the river Nile and how the Nile is traveling. So WSMU 13, for example, which is this blue line here, that's the lower Connecticut River Valley. Well, the Connecticut River is actually in New Hampshire, so it's not in the GIS layer for our rivers and streams to use for getting the river models. And so that whole river doesn't add into river models. So of course it's going to influence your calculation of water harvest for river models. Not only that, the Connecticut River is a rich source of water. Similarly, WSMU 12, which is in, that's the Deerfield Range, in south-central Vermont. Those who know that area know that there's a variety of lakes, Pigments, Harriman, D, Deerfield, Somerset, and a number of other smaller bodies of water. Well, the river miles does not capture those bodies of water as part of the density estimate. And otter, we know, utilize ponds and lakes. And WSMU2, which is the Nettowee Pulteney Rivers, it's the same thing. Castleton, or Bonazine, St. Vincent, Catherine, and a plethora of little lakes and ponds scattered all over that watershed management that are not categorized. So I only emphasize this so that this doesn't alarm people when they see that. Essentially, our otter harvest across the state is per density is pretty stable. As is our trapper success and the numbers of animals that each trapper is taking. Again, back in 1988, there is no significant trend in the increase in the number of successful trappers here. None. The numbers that they are individually taking has increased a little bit, but it's a pretty weak trend, but there has been some increase. And unlike the bobcat, there's no hunter harvest on the farm, so we don't have that complication. This is solely trappers here. Then when you look at the age structure of the otter population, this is statewide. This isn't broken under any watershed management, which we did do. So with the bobcat and those relations, those otter correlations and cross correlations, you can kind of see if something's driving something else harvest. But here, these are very stable. There's no significant trends here at all. And this down here, a little bit of a mystery what happened there, but I think it's actually a result of just the data collection process more than anything.
It's probably very low sample size.
I think that's exactly
that's
what it is.
Almost absurd what it is.
I don't know what this means here. I've scratched my head on that one, but I haven't come up with it. There's a lot of variables that can affect this, but there's no significant trends. And these are healthy lines here. And we already talked about the Downing model and its limitations and its intent. I won't go through that again here, but this is the Downing model. And again, it's just showing that there is some trending in this population, which I believe to be true, based on beaver, based on an assessment of the harvest and everything else.
Chris emphasized on this, and the same thing with the bobcat, is that this is compiling the heart. The population is actually being harvested. I mean, so if that population is growing over time, it's suggesting that the harvesting is not having much influence on population level, unless in some way it's increasing, which is unlikely. And then on top of this, you have the portions of the population that nobody harvests, has no access to. Well, that's added on top of this.
And in our recommendations, I believe, I highlighted that.
Yep. And that's an important thing.
The harvest population, put it in perspective, I forget the numbers exactly here, but I think it was something like 87 successful trappers. Picked the year of the highest harvest, 254 hours, that's a record harvest. 87 successful trappers. Well, that's roughly one trapper for three towns. And that same year, based on trapper mill survey data, the average number of traps that trappers put out was 5. So trappers are not effectively covering the whole state. In fact, it's a minority of the state that they are trapping. So here's the last bit of it. And that is, this is a trend that we can rely on. We don't have all the variables. We don't have WSMUs that are experiencing different things with respect to harvests. We saw the bobcat. We don't have hunting. We have a longer season that allows us to trend better. And you look at this, and quite frankly, I don't really need statistical analysis to look at this and to suggest that we're not talking many animals through the month of March if the season is extended.
What's your number, Chris? 7? 8?
Yeah.
Now, I mean, again, it will be varied from year to year, but on average over the long haul, I would guess it would be in that order.
And we estimate what, 3 to 11?
3 to 11. So the other part of the tier 2 is, okay, so if we expand the season into March, we continue to harvest beaver during that season, which has netted direct benefits to us in the sense of keeping, as to our greatest extent possible, the amount of beaver taken out of season to a minimum. Not eliminating, but helping. Don't mess with that. In fact, that alone could actually make up for the difference. An otter that would be harvested here as a result of the season expansion because of potential for incidental take of otter and nuisance beaver traps out of season. Again, there is no rules for that in the sense that you don't have to have a license, you don't have to have any education in the sense of trapper education to do that kind of work. I think it would be a much better scenario to have licensed trappers with experience using the best quality tools we've got in a season who utilize these resources than having them be turned into a nuisance and further degrading public perception, which further degrades our ability to manage them and to keep them as abundant as we have, and possibly even reduce our take during that time of year. It just makes sense in that regard. But the thing that has been brought up, and it is a concern, it bothered me. I stumbled on this one for a while, is that, well, if you extend this up to March, aren't you going to be abandoning pups? Right? We're getting into that parturition, that birthing period. When you go to the literature and you look at otter, you're going to find a range of birthing dates, parturition, right? You've got February to April. Well, in the northern climates, we tend to be on the latter part of that. Definitive. The thing to understand here is that we have been collecting every otter carcass harvested in the state of Vermont for decades. And unlike Fisher, there's not a lot of sexual dimorphism between the sexes, meaning that they look similar and they're harder to determine one from the other, especially once the trapper has removed the pellet. And so if there's no baculum, which is the penis bone on an otter, they're a mustela, if there's no baculum, we open up the animal to look at the reproductive tract to determine its sex definitively. In my 22 years here, I haven't really about handled, I did the math on it, I want to say it was in excess of 100 female otters, well actually I'll say I, and then pause. In fact, there's a lot of people who really participated in that effort, the necropsies. But we have looked at in excess of 100 females harvested in February and actually looked at their reproductive tracts, and only once, inexplicably, did we see anything that even resembled anything. You open up these otter and you look, there is nothing but a reproductive tract, except for this one time in 2011 where they were developed, still very small, a long way from birth. But they were developed pups and fetuses. So yes, I guess that would indicate, if I guess that's possible, that that could have been born in March. But the other part of the puzzle here is that birthing mothers or pup-rearing mothers aren't necessarily out on the landscape to the extent that males are. And you look at like New York's experience where they track these things. As you get in, their season goes into April. And looking at apples and apples, I asked specifically what's happening in March. And in March, their harvest is 70% males because females are moving toward parturition, and then later as they get into April, actual birth and pup rearing. And so they are harvesting more males, which is good. That's what we want in that scenario, because you can be avoiding. So I think when you're talking
the numbers we're talking about in the sense of additional harvest being in the single digits, and then 70% of them being males, and then the likelihood that they are going to give birth in March based on our observations over years of harvest examinations, I don't think that it's a real issue. Yeah.
What's a gestation period for otters?
62, 63 days. Last slide. So, summary. You know, the current level of harvest, there's no detectable influence of harvest upon this population. From our analysis, based on harvest data, based on section age structure, collected from carcasses. We could actually do better with better carbon mill survey to get better effort data in there. But the data we have, pretty clearly, there's no detectable influence. The number of otter harvested by an extension, as we just talked about, would be very pretty few. And it's even possible that it would be more than offset by saving on out of season, as we've already talked about, the incidental water taking to reduce feeder travel. And the issue with pup abandonment, I don't see it there. I'm not going to say that it would never be possible. I didn't see that one in 2011. Even that one, I wasn't convinced that it would have made it to maturation by the end of March. So it is in all of this, I would, you know, come to the conclusion that it would make sense to move that season forward. And simultaneously address the trigger rule to restore proper trap function to maximize functioning of that trap to make sure that it is operating the way it's supposed to operate. That, I think, concludes the show.
Any otter questions, folks, from the board? Yes, thanks, Justin and Patrick.
Yeah, otters are caught by which type of trap? Would it be a drowning trap, the conibear crushing trap, or the above ground trap?
Well, they're aquatic, so they are in water. It could be either a foothold or a conibear. I think if you don't track what traps are being used by our trappers, I mean, there are rules which regulate it, but we're not asking them which of those that are allowed are being used. But I think it's fair to say that the majority are being caught in body-driven traps.
Okay. So some of them, they'll have to dispatch the animal.
Well, again, for a whole trap, and in an outset, they also use an aquatic environment as a kill sound.
Yeah.
Thanks, Scott.
Chris, do you know what the current average incidental take is for otter throughout the rest of the feeder season?
Oh, I didn't know that. I should have that.
Yeah. Patrick, I'm sorry. Someone couldn't hear you back here. I'm asking about the incidental take.
Yeah, I have that. I have been struggling to keep a lot of these numbers in my head, as you might imagine. But it is, again, actually, I think it was 5 on average from 2000 to present. This is the key here, is that we have no way of knowing definitively how many are taken out of season, because there's no reporting requirement for otter taken out of season as incidental to feeder traps, nuisance feeder traps. So the only way of getting that here, the only requirement that the statute allows affords, is that if a landowner wants to keep that animal for their purposes, then they have to get it, they have to give up the carcass to a warden. So that's where that data comes from. It's definitive. At least on average, 5 otter have been taken out of season. We don't know how many beyond those that were actually chosen to cap five on that. I didn't explain that very well.
No, I mean, basically what it sounds like is that, assuming there's some that aren't reported, the average number of the incidental take is probably the same as the projected take throughout the rest of the month of March.
Run that past me one more time.
If the projected take by extended season is somewhere between 3 to 11.
3 to 11.
Is that
good? Yes.
All right. And you have five on average over the last few years, and assume that some are not reported. This is fairly similar what the incidental take would be as what you projected.
It is. Yeah. It is. Yes.
I have a bobcat question. Is that okay?
Absolutely.
You know, along Patrick's comment, back talking about the bobcat, you said incidental catches are an average of 2 in the last 2 weeks.
The last 2 weeks?
Or
incidental
takes. So wouldn't that be a good estimation of how many would be taken if the season was expanded?
Not necessarily, no. Those are the animals that are killed in convict traps set for fishing.
Yep.
So there are foothold traps people use widely for bobcats.
Yep. Like
they don't target them at the end of the season. Right, the bobcat season ends, they stop deploying foothold traps. But if you extend the season, that does not prohibit someone from setting foothold traps for bobcats.
Yep.
So again, you can't use that number to suggest that that is what would result. I mean, the proposal doesn't go into any, the petition didn't go into detail, but in conversations with people, the intent was never to change the rule of elevating Conibear off the ground after the close of the season, which it didn't go into the similar to otter with the triggers being in the rule to try to minimize the likelihood of bobcat being taken in the last half of the summer.
Okay, so Kevin wasn't clear if the intent was to take that away?
No.
And extend it or to keep it?
I don't think that was the intent. It wasn't in the petition. It didn't specify it.
So Chris, just to clarify though, if foothold traps are set in the latter half of the season, trappers now, if they catch a bobcat and one can release it unharmed and let it go, if the season is expanded, then a cat caught in a foothold trap would then be something that could be taken.
Yeah, and assuming if it were to stay the same, it would only be an average of 2 cats.
Other questions? Thank you.
We're going back to otters. Don't they, if somebody wants to keep the pelt, they need to acquire a CITES tag for that?
They want to export it out, yeah.
Well, actually, to keep it.
No.
So
I don't believe it. I want law enforcement to weigh in on that one. But my understanding is CITES tag is where it's being exported out.
Let's hear from Dave. Yeah, thank you. So the question was, if an animal is taken out of season, does it have to have a CITES tag always?
For
if it's going to be kept?
If it's going to go to market, it's going to be sold, yes.
Or if somebody wants to bring it to a taxidermist.
Correct.
It
would have to be tagged, yes.
If it goes to a taxidermist in the state, mm-hmm. with a CITES tag.
Okay, so as of right now, if any of those otters are taken as in the simple take, they're not having people require them to get a CITES tag if they want to keep the pelt?
Again, so otter is taken out of season, that the landowner chooses to keep it, they have to contact the game, and then they're going to get a CITES tag.
Okay.
That's already, the order is already taken the carcass. Tag the fur appropriately and the carcass. That's a done deal. So that's included in that on average 5, I think that's it.
Okay, you hadn't said anything about CITES tag in the other season, so that's why I wanted that clarified.
Yeah.
Yes, thanks.
So in your catch trend for your otters, to at least give us some idea of what the catch might be.
So again, you have increase in harvest potential, not as a result of any changes here, already increasing with respect to hunter harvest. You have increasing harvest resulting from trapper taking as well. and then you have a very clear response to favorable conditions and pelt prices that can jump that up pretty quickly, then you've got, you know, the variance across the landscape with respect to the harvest density that's taking place. I mean, there's a lot of variables mixed in there. I mean, you might be able to come up with a number, but I have no confidence in it. I have no confidence.
Well, I have one more question. You might want to get your bag for this one. why couldn't the department see, and how you know each bobcat that's taken has to be tagged and reported, do like a 3-year test period to see what the extra take would be for extending the season for the 2 weeks?
I guess I would rather act in caution, and I'd rather try to answer some of these questions that we put forth, you know, with respect to the age and sex structure and the effort data. I mean, that's what we need to do. I don't want to put species at risk of any experimental way.
But in your assessment, you're saying that there's a perfectly stable population, abundant population.
No, if I said a perfectly stable population. I mean, it's a healthy.
You can read it if you want. Healthy, stable population.
Right. I mean, yes. Stable with its variability.
But you said there's really no influences per se on them right now.
Right.
Well, that's what I'm saying. If
in terms of hunting and trapping, it's right. Not setting the population.
That's right.
If you did it.
That's where we want to be. That's where, you know, you don't want to be driving the population through harvest. Other species, like we just talked about with beaver, it's different. I mean, every species is different. There are different objectives.
Well, it's not your mind, there's a significant portion of harvest of bobcats are hunters.
That's right.
It's not just trapping. So that does exist with otters.
So there's another reason for caution there.
There's increasing trapping on all fronts. Which again, I don't think that's a jump up and down. I think it's just a large amount.
Chris, how many acres is Vermont? Like
6.
So when you talk about incidental take of 2 animals on 6 million acres, that seems like a small number.
Don't quote me on the...
Well, we'll say it's 5 million. We'll cut you. We'll cut you.
$1 million. So
18%. I'm sorry. That's inappropriate, ma'am. This is not how we run a meeting. I'm sorry. Ma'am, you may stay if required. Sorry. Thank you, guys.
Say again.
My question was on 5 million acres, if you have 2 incidental catches or 6, that is a really small mathematical number.
It is.
And I think a testament to something, but it is small.
It's a small one.
Okay. Any other questions for Chris?
Yep.
Yes, Phil?
Okay, we got trappers harvesting bobcats, hunters harvesting bobcats. If they were to extend the season on bobcats, could you say that the hunter take might go down because they're not there anymore if we harvest them?
If you increase the size, I just want to make sure I'm rephrasing this, just make sure I get it. You're asking if you increase the harvest of bobcats during the trapping season,
yeah,
would that influence potential take by hunting thereafter?
Yes.
I'd say that is, there is some potential there, certainly. And if you recall the 2 graphs that I put up, and this is, you know, without effort data, I am really, that's where that data is so critical for us to be able to determine. But the graph, I think it was here, the Northern Vermont Piedmont and the Middle Green Mountains, for those spikes in autumn, bobcat harvest. One of those, I think it was the Northern Green Mountains, there, those 2 years where we actually had a spike of bobcat harvest from trappers, there were no bobcats harvested by hunting.
And they were hunting the full size of that in the years leading up to half. But I don't know what the evidence is there.
Yeah, I would venture to guess if you went back and checked your weather, you would find those 2 years where the bobcat harvest was high in trapping, that there was heavy snow.
Yeah.
It's darn hard to run bobcats in heavy snow with dogs.
I get that.
They don't tree and stay there. They jump out and take off again, and it makes it hard to take them. So that's why you have a high harvest in Champlain Valley. Because it's a completely different climate than over here.
Can I just jump in on your original question about whether or not the trappers would be sort of removing bobcats that hunters could take? Well, of course, a lot of that's going to depend. I don't think anybody can really know, because a lot of that's going to depend on if those are the same bobcat populations each one is harvesting. In other words, you're harvesting a population that is accessible to you. Now, if the hunters are trapping or are harvesting a population of bobcats in different areas than typically the trappers do, there's not going to necessarily be a lot of overlap there. But if they are homing in on the same available population, exposed and population at risk, then they would. So it's really a hard question to answer, really, because you don't know if they're actually debiting the same population of bobcats, because they may be hunting and trapping in different places, very different places.
Yeah, I assumed it was a hard question.
It is a hard question.
But it's also a hard question to figure out how many bobcats are going to be caught from the 16th to the 31st. And if the suggestion was that we try a three-year period and revisit it, then you have data. What you've done here with this report, which hasn't been done for 15 years, is now you have a baseline that you can go back to.
This is admittedly a deeper look into it than we normally do. We do a lot every year, through the process of collecting our data, compile, analyze, and track. Because of conversations, require a deeper look to address appropriately the petition. But your point taken aside from that.
Cheryl, yes.
You know, I just want to say you have a ton of fantastic data in this report. You really do. I think it's fantastic. The harvest data is there. It's solid. It doesn't lie. Mandatory to put bobcats, fishers, otters in. I think that's great. The one major loophole that I see, or not really loophole, but issue, is the fact that you're not getting that effort. So my question is it only a mail-in survey?
Yeah.
Why can't it be recorded online?
Well, we had an online, the earlier edition of it online. There are issues with that.
How many years ago?
That was ways back, and it's not effective. And we have talked about that.
Yeah, but that was years back. I mean, now the technological leap has been incredible.
But
also, all the folks that bring in the bobcats and the fishers, do every one of those folks turn in a hunter effort survey?
No.
It should be mandatory.
I mean, they have to turn in the carcass.
Yep.
But they do not have to turn in the survey.
Do you know every person that turns one in? It's a real simple way if you get the effort to put forth when those have been brought in. Just thought. What else? Hunters. All the hunters out of the license holders. That's another one. I think that's very workable. Have your department ever considered a tag free of charge, kind of like the model that New York does?
We've talked about that, absolutely.
Yeah. I mean, I think that'd be another great way to track and differentiate how many license holders are actually going to be actively seeking bobcats. I mean, I think that there's great, I think those additions, before I think we vote on any of these, I think we should really address some of these data collection issues. Just my thoughts.
Commissioner, you talk a little bit about the purview of the board. Do we have permission to set a regulation that would mandate trapper surveys?
I believe you could, right? You can mandate requirements in order to have a license
for hunting and trapping, you think?
I would expect so. I'd want to talk a little bit more with the board about the difficulties of doing a hunter tag. If you were going to go that way, we could make you a proposal, but I'd like to have a little bit more time for Chris and other members of the department to talk about some of the challenges of a hunter fur bearer tag would propose. Also, some of the advantages we would have.
So it sounds like, Cheryl, we could meet that requirement of a mandate. Yeah. Other questions? Yes?
One thing that might be of consideration is if we were to go to the last 2 weeks or include the last 2 weeks of December for Bobcat, one of those weeks is a big vacation week, which would put potentially a lot more trappers in the woods during that week, which could be a bigger take, which we don't know about.
Another pair.
This is gears. Right. Teresa, yes.
Yes, looking at some of the upswings in the bobcat take, could part of that, because of the food source, comes and goes in ways in the snowshoe hares, you know, they have an upswing, so when there's a food source, bobcats have a lot of food, so they're going to have more kits, they're going to survive, so it's going to have a higher take because they're doing well, and then they're going to go down because of food source. So if you're looking at the trend...
Okay, that's where effort data...
Right, and I totally agree with Cheryl. I had written that down. That's, you know, you have to submit a fur buyer's report to get, you know, to get your new license in July. So again, we're not talking 100,000. We're talking 1,000. How many licensed trappers do we have right now?
Change the community year, but we're in the call park of 7,800.
Right. And you're only getting 20%.
About 20 to 30 recent
right.
years. We have
about
a long and very good trapper.
54% of them are only trapping.
Right.
So 2%.
Right.
Half of them, basically.
Mm-hmm. And I will...
The colonel has a comment.
Chris, just a brief addition, if I can. Blue cards are mandatory, and they're a time when a board visits a trapper. Maybe a backside of those blue card for an effort survey would take 5 minutes with a board face-to-face. Not to volunteer more work for my guys and gals, but it would be a sure way to get it.
Jason, excuse me, are you talking about that individual items that they're submitting, like their otter or fisher with the blue tag, so that hunter survey would be just how many hours it took to get this one particular animal?
Or how, you know, whatever that, I'm not familiar with the effort survey, so whatever that would entail on the backside of that car or in addition to that car. I can't imagine it's a difficult survey to fill out. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
How are we doing? Any other questions for Chris here? Topics A to Z? Yes. All right. We're going late, but we're going to keep going. Thank you, Chris. Appreciate it.
Yes.
That makes sense.
I really like to take I know this is tough, a quick 5-minute break for bathrooms. That's probably fair. I know there's 4 bathrooms across the road here. There's 2 at back as well on this building. Let's see if we can get right back to work.
We have about, it's like about, well, if people check the guest slightly, she has like to speak today. Looks like we have about maybe 25 minutes worth here. Some people wrote it time allowed, which is generous, but you know, we can do that. I think we have time for it now. What I'd like to say is, you know, we have so many experts in the room. It'd be great if everybody who we could point to and say they're an expert can speak for more than a minute, you know? I'd love to be the expert who gets to speak for more. But this is not a hearing. In a hearing, we don't shut you down. We don't say, gee, you're out of order. Here, we just have a lot of people, many of them now past 9 o'clock, who some of them have to drive to Bennington, some have to drive to, you know, the islands all over the place. So we're going to limit to a minute. We don't limit our access to ourselves. You can certainly talk to us at other times. What I'm going to do is just take this list, and I'll do front page, back and forth, down through all those yeses. If you start to hear redundancy, or if you start to hear something you've already heard, what you can expect then is that, you know, maybe the point has been made. I don't want to silence anybody. That's not my job. This is my position.
I think if we had a cheering contest like they do at middle school basketball games, that'd be exciting, but that's not what we're here for. So, we have a timer tonight. Is there someone who can help us out? All these fancy phones.
Can you just clarify? I think some people thought just by putting your name down, that meant you wanted to see it. Maybe
they
see the yes
column. Thank you for saying that. I certainly don't want to limit folks. I'm just going to stand up during this, not because I need to, be authoritarian, but just because I want to hear. I want to make sure we're having eye contact. While people are speaking, just please, let's listen. Let's not be detractors from this event as it's gone so well so far. Someone might say something you disagree with. Is there a surprise in that? I hope not. So here we go.
Chair, if I can just add one brief addition to that. When you stand up, please say who you are, what town you're from, your name, your full name, so we can keep track of the comments. That's very helpful. And also, please don't cheer or clap for folks. There are many people who are saying things tonight that will have support from other folks in the room. We get that. If we cheer and clap, we're just going to be here until summer. So I understand that there's support of different positions here, so thanks.
I apologize for interrupting. I'm from Vermont Public Radio, Peter Hirschfeld, and I'm doing a story on this hearing. So I'm going to be running around to whoever stands up. And if you're willing to hold the mic while you're offering your comment, I'd be grateful.
Thank you, Peter. I wonder who you were. So, again, thank you so much. We'll just start. We hear from Sean Smith first, please.
Kevin, can we put a time limit on this?
A minute.
I got it right.
Yeah,
here.
But I mean total. Like till it's quarter of 9, 10 o'clock or something.
Pete, I take your point very well. I'm not sure how to set that. What's your suggestion?
10 o'clock. That's an hour and 15 minutes.
Okay.
We can't get it done by then.
I agree with you. Board members, what do you think?
How many people are on the list?
That mathematically, that would be way, way more generous time than we'll need. So.
9:15. 9:18.
I'll take a pass.
All right, let's go. So I'm going to call on Sean Smith in a second. How about Walter Anderson first? Is Walter Anderson ready for us?
Thank you. I'm Walter Anderson, Mike Park. I was a trapper, and I quit, believe it or not, 60 years ago. And I don't believe the bobcat or the otter should be killed at all, especially as it's killing with increased in time.
Thanks. Sean Smith? I'm going to keep moving up the line if I don't see those people. Okay, thank you.
Hi, I'm Sean Smith. I'm from Huntington. I am a farmer, and I'm a steward of 1,300 acres at the base of Camel Hump State Park. I'm also a wildlife tracker. And the way that we steward our farm is by working in collaboration with our wildlife neighbors. So the presence of all these species on our property thriving and engaging in the natural resource world that we operate in is critical to the success of the work that we're doing. And the kind of farming that we are trying to demonstrate is not only better for the planet and for natural resources like water and air and soil, but has great potential for Vermont's long-term working landscape economy. And the health of our wildlife is critical to this kind of farming that we are trying to popularize. So for us, making sure that our wildlife species populations are strong and healthy is really important.
Larry Martin, you say your name and where town you're from in Vermont.
I'm Larry Martin from Worcester, Vermont. And if you don't know where Worcester is, it's just north of Mount Bay. If you're blunt on the way through, you probably miss it. First of all, I want to commend the Fish and Wildlife team for an excellent report. Just thank you. When I first heard about the possibility for a proposal to extend the otter and the bobcat season, I started doing my own observation. And since that time frame, I have seen 5 different bobcats and had numerous pictures of cats on trail cameras, but I've also seen 11 otter. I believe in my area, that the otter and the bobcat may be at their peak population for my lifetime. So based on that and reports from Chris, I would ask the board to vote for the extension for the bobcat and for the extension for the otter. Also, due to the information Chris gave us on colony trap, I
thank you, sir.
Would like that too.
Thank you. Go here from Melissa Hoffman.
Hi, I'm Melissa Hoffman. I'm also from Huntington. I moved here in 1994, to farm. So I've been in a Vermont resident in the farming areas on and off for the last over 20 years. I farm with Sean on the same property. And just to add to what you said about the wildlife, I so appreciate the dedication to science in making these decisions. We work very closely with Sue Morse, who is a wildlife ecologist, a hunter, and a tracker. And I know that there's valuable data out there that can be gained through observation over time, as she has done. And we rely on that kind of data very heavily in how we design our food system and monitor all the energy transactions and nutrient exchanges that are occurring on our property in conjunction with our farm. And so I just want to promote other ways of seeking data other than through carcass collection. And I know that that's a very, very important source of information.
Thank you. Bruce Barofio.
I'm Bruce Barofio. I'm president of the Vermont Trappers Association, and I'd like to urge the board to adopt a proposal. The Trappers Association, at their last meeting, the members unanimously asked me to ask the board to task the department with making the trapper survey mandatory. You've got to go online to get the license. You should be able to fill out the survey online easily. As far as the hunters, you'll have to figure that out for yourself. Bobcat population in the state, depending on Chris's work, is which dynamic you use, is either 687 animals or 2,110 animals. At 10%, harvest rate for 687 or less than 1% at 2,100, 2 weeks is not going to make a statistical difference at all, and it would simplify things a very lot.
Thank you. A person named N-I-K-A-I-L, I could say Mikhail.
He's left.
We'll keep moving up the list. Maya?
She left as well.
What the heck? She's got kids' handwriting. I think this little one. Yeshua?
Sure. I'm going to speak really fast because a minute is not enough. When I was 7 years old, I went to SeaWorld in Florida. During one of the shows, an otter came out on stage to open and deliver a can of Pepsi to one of the trainers. While we were talking, or while most people were thinking about Pepsi, I sat in awe of these incredible beings and realized their emotional and intellectual capacity was far beyond any of what my peers gave them credit for. I am now 31 years old and I have 4 young children, all under the age of 8. It's very likely that I will see another 100 years on this planet. But that is only if people such as yourself begin to listen to people like me. In fact, my children's grandchildren will live with the results of the decisions you make. Can you even fathom how many people you will affect and the extent to which your power reverberates through our future? I cannot. For me, this issue goes way beyond the question of trapping for trophies. The effects of their removal from the ecosystem is beyond our comprehension. In the cacophony of climate change, it's clear to me that even with all the rhetoric about greenness and sustainable that, very little about our policies and lifestyles have changed, especially in America. Yet we see ourselves as leaders and innovators. Standing here before you, I wonder what sort of dystopian reality I live in, where instead of congratulating you on moving to abolish their inhumane slaughter, I'm pleading with you to come to your senses and see to our collective reality for what it is.
Thank you.
There is no denying that ecosystems everywhere are collapsing. I cannot fathom how those of us in positions of power
are
need to see or the intensity of the commitment. Policymakers everywhere must catch up and make sense of the reality we face.
If
you think I'm crazy,
removed.
Make such an assertion. I will point out that our neighbors only a few miles away in the state of New Hampshire have taken a far more respectable position than we have here.
Hold
for
the mic.
In 2007, the people of Ecuador rewrote their constitution by referendum. In doing so, they explicitly adopted and established the
sir,
right.
Would you please leave the room?
Well,
sir,
while you may return here or go after this session,
disturbing the
peace,
would you please leave the room?
In this very, I will in a minute.
No, it's leave the room now. You have disturbed this meeting. This is not what we're
all
here
life
for.
Is sacred and not here for
your
own words.
Please leave the room.
While they are already endangered, further reduction of their population.
I'm going to ask you to be removed from the room, please.
There are
chances of removing the room. This is not what we're here for.
Just give me a moment.
No.
Have your moment.
Please.
Can I just say one thing?
Can
I just say one thing very quickly here? We will hear from everybody before any rule goes into place.
written comments, public hearings. We will make sure that everybody has their chance to say everything they want to say. And thank you, sir. You've had your chance.
Yes, but my children have not. They had to leave. Okay. You don't have to put your hand on me. I will move. I will move. I do not need your hand on me. I will move.
Need Rodney Campbell.
Hi, I'm Rodney Campbell from Worcester, Vermont. I would like to ask the board to move these petitions forward, and I believe the population of bobcat and otter can support the additional trapping pressure. It's not going to be a lot of animals for the bobcat, and there is a lot of otter out there at this point in time. Thank you.
Holly Tippett.
I just want to make sure that the board pays attention to some written testimony that was submitted by a PhD, and someone who has a PhD in ecology, that actually throws a lot of water on the science that was used for both the bobcat and the otter population conclusions. There's some statistical analysis that was incorrect, and the scientific method was brought into question. So I guess I would really like to make sure that the board pays attention to that. Additionally, despite the fact that Chris was dismissive of the Wildlife Action Plan, that study and the decision to put those species into areas of greatest need meant that there were other pressures that are not taken into account in this study. Things like climate change, exposure to heavy metals, those kinds of things that will have both a short-term, medium, and long-term impact on these two species. Thank you.
Thank you. Mike Covey.
Hi, I'm Mike Covey, I'm from Williamstown. I authored this petition. I think that there's been such an influx of information sent to the board and everybody that there's no point in wasting a lot of time on it. What I would like to do is thank the department for all the work they did putting together such a great report. I'd like to thank the board for their diligence in hearing this petition. And I look forward to seeing the results.
Jenny Carter.
Hi, I'm Jenny Carter from Randolph. The first thing I'd just like to say, there was a misconception out here about the role of the legislature that they play in this, and people should be aware, while there is an extensive process ahead, the legislature plays virtually no role in this. They only look, they have a legislative committee that will look to make sure that the regulations don't violate any other state statutes, that they're acting within your authority, not whether it's good or bad or the data is good or bad. So people shouldn't think that the legislature really has very much of a role to play in this. Having said that, I hope that the board will not move forward on this petition, at least with respect to the otters and the bobcat. And given the shortness of time, I would also like to say I think the department did what it could with the data it had, but looking at the data, there are so many gaps in the data. I think the one thing we could all agree on is that we do need more data. There needs to be mandatory reporting for trapping, and as well as efforts taken to find nuisance animals.
Thank you. John Latree, did you want to speak?
Hi, I'm John Latree from Rutland. I'm in support of this petition. I believe the petition was submitted as one petition, but there's three components to it, and I urge the board to look at the three components and look at them independently, and maybe vote on one, well, vote on all of them, but break it down and look at them independently. And secondly, when Chris was flipping through his slideshow, he had some information up there on the bounty program with the bobcat, and it looked like there was a 20-year stretch or so where that bounty program was in place. And harvest numbers seem to be around the 300, if you average them, 300 harvested over a course of 20 years. And if we can support that type of harvest over a 20-year period, if we're looking at a few extra animals to extend bobcat season a couple weeks, 20 years should be enough time for the board to react to do something or implement something to curb the harvest numbers. Thank you.
Brenna Galdenzi.
I'm kind of echo. I'm Brenna Galdenzi, so I'm the president of Protect Our Wildlife, and I'm going to echo a bit of what Jenny said. And I also want to have a quote here. With regard to wildlife action plans, there are plans developed for conserving wildlife and habitat before they become too rare or costly to restore. And to quote Chairman Morris, he says in referring to the analysis, missing is any reference that interprets if expansion of the seasons would have any negative impacts on these healthy populations. Well, we couldn't agree more, because there is a large segment of data that is missing in order for this board to approve this petition on bobcats and otters. The cash per unit effort that's contained in the trapper mail survey, you have 20 to 30% of that data. The trappers have not even returned their surveys. Yet we're going to consider expanding the seasons on these two animals, these two cherished animals, for what? I'm not quite sure what problem we're seeking to solve.
Pat Coe? Sorry, it wasn't checked yes or no, but I want to give a chance. Pat, let's see.
She is gone.
All right, thank you. I'm sorry, Henry Coe then?
Yes. Hi, my name is Henry Coe. I'm from Danville. I own a woodlot in Albany. I have for 55 years. I can say happily I've never ever put a postal sign on there. I've always welcomed hunters, trappers, and fishermen and hikers. I talked this afternoon with an old friend from 1961, David Lawrence. John Capusta knows him. David Lawrence hunted bobcat on the Low Ridge all the way down to Hyde Park for 30 years. He said he wore a pair of snowshoes out every year. He would go with two dogs. He'd be ahead of the dogs by the end of the day. Old John is 80 now. He's too lame to come here. He gave me permission to speak on his behalf. He said, please do not extend the bobcat season. He said, if you want to hunt them, track them on snowshoes. He said, don't trap them with open conifer traps and leg hole jaw traps. He said, those should be outlawed in the United States. 8 states have outlawed them, but not the United States. 80 nations have outlawed
them. Thank you. We have run out of time.
Thank you.
These folks did not necessarily check they wanted to speak, but I'm just going to run down quickly. Gary Huck. Thank you.
My name is Jerry Huff. I'm from Roxbury. I have a farm there and also another business in Vermont. We would like the board to oppose, just based on talking to various people in Vermont for several years, I just don't have a lot of confidence in the data, the reporting data. I think you need to start looking at online sources. A lot of trappers don't report things. I've been told by trappers that they caught an owl, they called Fish and Wildlife, they told them to throw it into the woods. They caught a duck, they called for Fish and Wildlife, they got reported, Fish and Wildlife went there, they told them to throw it deeper in the woods, off the trail. So I don't have a lot of confidence in this data, and I don't understand how the board seems more like they're just arguing against the biologists to encourage the trapping. They don't seem like they're representing fairly all citizens.
Thank
so
you.
That's my point.
Candace Schaefer. Is Candace here? We've gone late, I'm sorry. Trey Nichols, do you want to speak?
Yeah,
thank you.
All right, so I'm Trey Nichols, I'm from Colchester, and I have to say that I oppose this petition. Traps, they pose serious dangers to the species that we are trying to conserve here in Vermont. And when I see deplorable photos and videos of animals that are struggling to free themselves from traps, and I see the hunters smiling and making jokes while sitting next to the carcasses, you know, that is nothing short of bullying behavior. I have nothing to lose. Wildlife, they have everything to lose. Animals will continue to be enslaved by traps if the petition to elongate the upcoming trapping season is approved. And until every animal is free, we're all victims. Until every animal is free, we must continue to take nonviolent, direct action to use our power to help rather than hurt
wildlife.
Thank
you, Trey. Help me with some pronunciation here. Jane Kleinsinger.
Pass.
Pass, thank you. Going right up. Pamela Dean, D-E-I-N.
I'm not sure if you pronounced that correctly. I'll
thank you.
My name is Pamela
Dean. I live in Stockbridge, Vermont, and I am on the board of directors of NTRAP, and on behalf of myself and all our supporters and our organization, we request that the board respectfully obtain more data before making a decision, as well as we oppose the petition. The petition thank you very much.
Very good. Tim Appleton. Is Tim here? David, I think it's Bart Creed. Bart, thank you.
Very good. I'm Dave Bart. I'm Andover. I hope the board will go ahead with these three recommendations. I see it looks like the data supports we have strong and probably increasing populations of these animals. It sounds logical that we could take some more without doing any harm to the animals that we do have. And from what I see, I see more otters and bobcats in my lifetime now than I ever did before. Thank you.
Looking for Diana, I think it's Sawyer, I'm not quite sure. Diana, want to speak? Eric, is it Truman?
I think she left.
Okay, thank you. Pat Mataferos, Bronte, what do you think?
Good, yeah. I'm Pat Mataferanti, I'm from Wilson, Vermont. I oppose this petition. I think the reasons have all been stated before. I think erring on the side of conservation is overall doubt, and from the what was shown today, that is what I think the whole department is about. And when I hear someone say, what's a few extra animals, it makes my blood run cold. I don't think that's conservation, and I don't think the people who say that are conservation. Thank you.
Bruce Martin.
Bruce Martin, I'll play Vermont. Again, thank you for the department for all the data they have put together, and I think the board has actually brought up some good ideas how trends are showing population going up and the catch going lower as the month extends. Why not a trial period? I mean, it's a good idea that the department could look into. I think it's a good suggestion by the board. And like many others, I'm out in the woods a lot. I see a lot of sign out there. And I think, again, the population of bobcat in central Vermont included is higher than 7,000.
Lark Shields.
Mark Shields from Crafter, and I'm against the petition, and I hope your mission statement is true. It says you care about all Vermonters, and from what I understand, there isn't anyone on this board that isn't a hunter or a trapper, and I'm neither. And I would like to see some representation from somebody else. I know the governor appoints them, but you have some power to do something about that. And I think then you would be reflective of all of Vermont. I also feel the science is definitely not there. For you to even consider extending this petition is ludicrous, in my opinion, and many others.
Thank you. Rick Schoonover.
Thank you. Rick Schoonover, Westminster, Vermont. I've been involved in water quality issues since I came back to Vietnam in 1967. Watched our water quality in Vermont, which I dearly love, degrade due to salt. A variety of different things. Otter are definitely a fish predator as our waters warm up, our salmonoids, our trout are stressed. I definitely think it's a good idea we trap a few more otters. I don't think we're going to trap enough to make an awful lot of difference. I feel it's pretty sad in this day and age with all the information out there that people still do not understand the foothold trap. With all the information out there, VMD process, International Association of Fish and Wildlife Agency data out there, scientifically obtained, that it's really sad that people are against a tool that's very humane without knowing a great deal about it. I am definitely in favor of otter, bobcat, and the entire petition. Thank you.
Thank you. And a Greg Pollard.
I'm Anna Gretz-Pollard. I have come a long way. I grew up in Germany and had experience of hunting during World War II, hunting to eat, and trying to preserve as many animals that we could find that could live and survive the carnage there. And I have wound up here in Vermont, and I have responsibility to, for 135 acres of woods. And interesting, just interesting area with all kinds of critters, some I don't even know. And my my purpose is to make that as healthy and let them grow as much as possible. I have made my peace with the beavers. They move, and we visit occasionally. And so this is fine. They no longer convert forests into wetlands. And I said, great, I don't have to deal with that. But I can't see trapping the animals, especially now when we were when we are into climate change and we have no clue what's coming.
Thank you. Chris Knapp. Chris here.
Hi, I'm Chris Knapp from Montreal, Vermont. And I want to thank the board for all the work they've done and the research that Chris did. I want to point out just one thing. If you look back in history, when wildlife management was in the hands of the public and the legislature, we almost wiped out all the animals. I'm very much in favor of this petition, and I hope the board will consider it and vote on it.
Jennifer Lovett.
Hi, I'm from Stanford, probably the southernmost representative here. I love the bear population, by the way, because I live right in the middle of all that. So I'm a conservation biologist, and I just want to note that I also looked at the critique of the assessment report by Dr. Weldon Bosworth, who is a PhD ecologist and environmental consultant, and he concluded in this, I'm reading this because it's kind of a quote, that the report provides absolutely no scientific foundation or evidence for any management decision related to bobcats or otters. I also have read the, much of the 1,000 pages of the Wildlife Action Plan, or whatever it's called, and bobcats are identified as a medium-level species of greatest conservation need. There are three levels, and they are in the middle, and I think climate change plays a real strong role in this, because we don't know exactly what the population is here, and we don't know what is going to happen to them with the result of the predator-prey cycle and climate change as an element in all of this.
All right, thank you.
And with otters as well.
Okay. Folks, I really appreciate your listening. This is going great. Barry Londeree.
My name is Barry Longray. I'm from Burlington, Vermont, and I'm here to oppose the petition. I think I'll focus briefly on bobcats because I think that's the part that is most important here. I think I hope the board listens to the recommendations of the department. You know, to summarize what we have a stable population. We have increasing opportunities of successful trappers and trapping of bobcats. We have low incidental takes during the 2 weeks of fisher season. And we have a high uncertainty of what extending that bobcat season for 2 weeks. I think there should be overwhelming evidence for this board to vote to extend that season, to double it. And that evidence has not been presented today. A lot of that's because of lack of data, but without that information, the board should not move forward. Thank you.
Jacqueline Carr.
Jacqueline Carr, I'm from Texas, Vermont, and I oppose this petition. I am also a professor of history at the University of Vermont and have to deal in my teaching, voluntarily do so, but with the devastation and violence that's been perpetrated against the animal population on this continent for several centuries. I don't really have anything else to add except to say that I oppose because the points that have been made collectively in opposition reflect my feelings. So I'll stop at that.
Thank you. Catherine Lawler.
She does.
Thank you. Tom Dibble. No Tom? Walt Cottrell? All set? Peggy Larson?
My name is Peggy Larson. I'm a veterinarian. I also have a master's degree in pathology
and I also have a law degree. I've been a state prosecutor. Recently, Canada has declared that animals are sentient. The FBI has declared that animals are sentient because 49% of the interfamily domestic abuse often involves animals. So the FBI has come up and has mentioned that the animals are sentient. I listen to you people when you talk about these animals like the commodities, like they're a sausage or a cabbage or something. If you were doing this to dogs or cats, under Title 13, you would be facing a state's attorney. As a veterinarian, I have removed legs from animals who have been caught in traps because traps are not, they don't discriminate. They take other species. And so the last cat I took a leg off of, she didn't survive. She probably was in there 3 or 4 days because of the
dehydration. It's time. Thank you. Appreciate it.
I'm Gabby Rapp.
Rosalind, Ben? Rosalind here? Bonnie Mullen? Rob Mullen?
Yep.
Thank you.
I'll keep it very short. Most of what I would say has been said. By chance, I also was in one of the kids who was the first week of the first year this camp was open in 1968 or 9. Did very well there. Anyway, I do oppose this motion. I've been ambiguous about trapping for most of my adult life until recently. Nonetheless, for the reasons people put, I have green biology from UVM, and good science is driven by good data, and as Chris did a wonderful job of the presentation with the data he's got, he does not have the data he needs, and I think the erring on the side of caution is the department is one. Thank you.
Walter Grant?
No comment.
Thank you, I'm sorry. And Trevian Stenger?
Thank you. Good afternoon to speak. My name is Trevian Stenger. I'm a student in Vermont, and I'm an educator and working in water quality, stream restoration, water, wetland restoration. So I'm going to travel with all of you. I wanted to make Vermont as great as it can be. However, I thought a little bit at the narrow confines of this debate. I'd love the board to also be thinking about other, perhaps broader future leading ideas. Are we really needing to argue on small amounts of animals? Are we basing this only on how many bobcats there happen to be this year? Why can't we have significantly more in the future? Why do we need to stall out at only this amount? The future of Vermont's going to be a clean, green place, and that's what a lot of our children are going to want. Do we only need to sort of go for the deal of less than 0.25% of Vermonters are trappers? Be respectful people, but for them to take permanently parts of our shared resource or our shared quality of life, I'd be like people stealing things, people taking away other people's opportunities.
Thank you. Erica, it's here. Is Erica here? I'm just going to check real quickly. I don't want to feel left out here. I know some people at the last minute feel inspired, but I'm just going to go by this list. I believe that's everybody who has signed up to speak. So, thank you, board, for your patience. That, and thank you, public.
My name is Daniel, and I'm from Stowe. Two points. So I oppose the petition. One is that I was concerned about Chris's presentation in the sense it was as good as you could do, I think, today. But there was one mention of the welfare of animals in the whole 2 hours, and that was, in the context of extending the oxygen. And there was 11 mentions of profit and money and market share. So that was a dichotomy that was troubling. And then the other point I want to make is that to the gentleman in the corner, the bobcat season is the bobcats, we want to see more of them. And the final point is the nepotism that I'm seeing from some of the board members with the people that are trappers. It's very troubling to me, and I think there's
an
imbalance there. So it's something we should all pay attention to.
Thank you. Well, we did leave a time and we'd have a sign-up procedure. I've seen, I've seen you here for the whole evening. I'm not sure what the problem is.
I would like to speak.
Would you be the last one? Let's hear it. Thank you.
My name is Kimberly, and I'm from Vermont. I just want to say that that was a great presentation. Thank you. And the mayor one, that was great, too. I've lived in Vermont for 16 years. For 16 years, I'm an avid hiker, kayaker, snowshoer. I've never once seen a bobcat.
Me neither.
Not once. I've never seen a trap. I've never seen anything. I've never seen a bobcat. I've never seen an otter. Never seen one otter. And I'm on every lake and stream kayaking. Never seen one. So I know you've seen a lot of them. And this gentleman over here said he just saw somebody that saw three. What, recently? They're not out there as much as you think they are. I should be seeing them, and I'm not seeing them. And also, there's nobody representing the animals on this board. There should be somebody representing the animals who is not a predator with an untraveled.
Thank you. All right, so we've got some business to do, folks. The department has made it clear that they want you to, hear the issues, think about it. Tonight, if we come forward with a proposal that we vote on as the opening petition, the danger of that, of course, is that we do something that's not articulated correctly, that has flaws in it, that, as smart as we all think we are, one at a time, perhaps it would be better to tell the department what your wishes are, and after that, move forward with language that they create for you to vote on at our next meeting. However, I don't know what your wishes are. So we can break this petition down into three parts if you're ready for this expediency. I've heard from a couple of you to say, I'm not sure we're ready for this, but why don't I hear your comments on what you want to do? Thanks, Cheryl.
I don't know what everyone else thinks, but I think before we even vote on the petition as it is, I think we should kind of come up with some common guidelines as to what we're going to do about this effort, just so it can be brought forward with any, decisions that are going to be made on the three issues.
So the trapper survey,
yep.
You want to deal with that first? What do you think?
Is that something we're going to cook up or something we should send the department back to come up with a proposal and bring it back?
I view it as something the direct us to develop a proposal.
Okay.
And I would ask the board, too, to consider, are you looking at trappers? Are you looking at trappers and hunters?
Bill, yes?
Okay. I'm looking at this petition as a three-part petition.
Yep.
I would like to separate it into three parts. Bobcat, otter, colony traps. Personally, I see no reason why this board cannot vote on colony traps tonight and get it done. If you want to postpone on bobcats to discuss the mandatory survey, which the VTA said they voted for, I've got it written down on my notes, mandatory survey, or maybe survey to be able to get something that you can work on. I would ask that the Fish and Wildlife Department come back in December with something on that. That gives you October, November. I know you don't deer hunt that much, Lewis, so you go ahead and do it.
My deer hunt is not that successful.
Mark, what would be the result of pulling the colony trap out and saying we get the language for tonight, is that helpful or not?
To pass any of those four items, you've got four items now to talk about. The three in the petition, one about mandatory reporting. We'd have to amend the fur bearer rule. So the rule would be open. So what I encourage you is to think about all the changes that you want in the fur bearer rule at one time. Let us come back with proper language and our thoughts on how you would most effectively do that. You don't want to have that rule opened up, just closed, opened again. You constantly going back to the first vote. So because once you do a first vote on any part of that rule, it opens up the whole rule for the public process.
So I hear you saying, Bill, that maybe the colony trap issue is not going to be a huge conflict amongst the board and the public. No one mentioned much about it tonight. It sounds like we should do all of this at the same time when we do it.
But if we don't
vote one way or the other. We haven't said whether to open this rule up or not for the first vote. We have to do a first vote to decide if we're going to keep going with the petition or if it dies.
It's like you're just hoping for like a straw vote, grant from you folks, just like we've done before on waterfall process or even the fear permits or moves. You're not locked into that. But that gives us direction and how to carefully craft the rule language instead of trying to do it right here at 14 people.
Keep in mind that unless I'm wrong about this, nothing that we do will affect this coming winter's trapping season. Right. So anything you do will be done in time to go into effect for next year. So I don't think there's a huge time crunch in moving some pieces.
Is there any desire to split the bobcat into two different straw pools? Like I heard Craig mention, maybe a three-year trial as opposed to a straight-out change? Yes?
Kevin, how about a quota? So you got to extend it, just put a number on there, and when you hit that number, stop.
We had real problems with the quota. I don't mean to direct what the board does. I just, for information purposes, we had real problems when we had a quota in the past. Because people would be harvesting animals after the quota had been met, but before they could be informed. So, just for information.
You have 10 days before you have to report your numbers.
10 days or 48 hours?
Oh, I'm sorry. Once you touch your animal, 10 days to get a tag. Yes?
I don't know if this is the time for me to put my 2 cents forth here, but concerning the entire thing here, we have stirred up one hell of a hornet's nest for maybe two more bobcats, a handful more of otters. By the time the legislature may get done with us, after this hornet's nest cools down, we may have an entirely different board with a few anti-hunters on it, which I know the legislature would like to see. I have been around that legislature a lot lately, and they are an entirely different legislature than they were even 5 years ago. There isn't a single hunter in the entire legislature that I know of. So we have to watch what we're doing here for five extra animals in bobcat season and a handful extra otters in otter season. As far as I'm concerned, I'm not going to kick that hornet's nest. So I am not going for it. And I am not an anti-hunter. I'll clue you in. But if you folks want to kick that hornet's nest, go for it. I'll be off of here in about 5 months. And I won't have to face whatever this board's going to look like.
Yes, thanks, Grant.
I ought to thank you due to the straw poll.
Pardon me?
I ought to thank you due to the straw poll.
Otter.
What I would say in response to Justin, nobody asked me, is that whatever the board does, I really don't think you need to take responsibility for what the legislature does. They're separate animals. They're going to do what they're going to do this year. You know, you folks have passing. You have your positions. We will do what we do. So, could you do a straw poll on whether or not you think the department should work on a mail survey? That's a mandatory survey. Mail is probably the wrong word. M-A-I-L. Maybe it should be a survey. So we're talking about a trapper response survey and do the best you can on the hunter survey. What, Bill, what do you think?
I think you include them both. They're taken fur bearers. Yeah. They ought to be able to do a survey. That's all there is to it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I just want to make sure that somewhere in there it makes it absolutely positive mandatory that if you did indeed put in a bobcat, fisher, or otter, that should be returned. Big emphasis. But I don't know how you can kind of weed out that. It's kind of like probably like an all or nothing. Or
if the board directs us to come back with something like this, we will come back to you with a couple of different ways of doing it, options, and strengths and weaknesses of each of us.
Okay. So they don't just be mandatory survey then.
Excuse me.
Yes?
When you sit down at your computer and do your, in my case, renewal, because I'm an old geezer, or a new license, first question on there, did you take a fur bearer? Yes or no? If you fill out yes, I don't care if you shot it while you were deer hunting, You shot it when you were calling it, or you trapped it? You fill out the survey. No. Get them all. You want information? Get it all.
Yeah, I, not to get into a long back and forth on something I'm not that knowledgeable about, but I would say that we probably will want to get trapper surveys returned from trappers who did not take a fur bearer as well to get effort. So just that's one of the nuances in what we'll come back with.
Okay. There's a lot of stuff that Fish and Wildlife can knock around about this. We don't need to settle all their problems on this. I'm in favor now of, if you're willing, just in a second here, a show of hands or go on the table, whatever we need to do, just to say, yep, the survey is important. It's so important. And next time we meet or in December, we'd like to see what you brought up about this. How can we solve this problem? So, got a lot of people here listening. Want to go around the table? Let's do that.
Sure.
So is the mail survey, or the survey so important that the Fish and Wildlife should return to us and tell us why it's that important and how we're going to solve that problem? Patrick?
Yeah.
Yes? Justin?
Yes.
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 Very important.
Yes.
And yes. Dave is out west, so you know he would vote. We have a colony trap proposal in front of us, bobcat and otter. I think it's been pretty clear. I think it would be in our best interest to split these this time. We'll open this, thing once, however. So the colony trap provision, which basically allows someone to set the colony trap in the water, under the water. The animals are going to be dead the first day. But people would be allowed to check on a 3-day check is the proposal. On a straw poll, is that something you could support? Yes or no? Patrick?
Yes.
Can I clarify one thing about regarding that? Chris's presentation said 3 calendar days. We have it listed as 72-hour check. Which way are we going with this?
The current regulation says 3 calendar days.
It's been petitioned as 72 hours, so.
I think they got rid of that 72 hours for a really good purpose, that, you know, mm-hmm. when you get out of your truck 5 minutes either way, could be a problem with that. So my understanding is that it was saved the 3-day.
Okay, because it's written Thank two different
you.
Ways.
I'm sorry to start voting here for your discussion. Any other questions about that? I'm tired of you. I have to drive a bus tomorrow to Compton, New Hampshire, okay? It feels right to me.
Pity those kids.
They'll be free. All right, so will the calling trap, proposal be supported with that 3-day check? Patrick said yes. Justin?
Yes.
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 I say yes. With a bobcat proposal, this is a straw poll kind of thing. We could vote it forward just as we have. We could split it and say, well, let's try 3 years with the sunset provision, which would require us to open it up again to maintain it or to change it. Of course, at any time, you can open up a rule and change it if that's what your desire is. You don't have to wait 3 years if the sky falls on the first year kind of thing. Any discussion on that? Yes.
Did you treat that as like a test water where the commissioner has the power to eliminate it?
I don't believe that I have the power to do the commissioner's test water rule in trapping. I think that has to be a board rule. Yeah. Captain loves Catania, and I don't have the
power. Any other questions? Yes.
Yeah, I mean, I'm still hung up on the original intent of the petition. Was it to completely eliminate the 5 foot to reduce the incidental take? Was it supposed to do away with that so you could keep the sets just like you would? Or was it to say that you could keep the incidental catches with it having that stipulation in place? I didn't really clarify that very well.
It's a good question, actually. That was clear.
And the reason why I asked is because the department knows how many incidental catches with that stipulation in there that they get. Right. So they know how many more, and it's like an average of 2. And I just think it's really important that we clarify that.
It's my belief that the goal was to eliminate the incidental takings or allow the incidental taking bobcat to be utilized. However, I think that it's likely that that would lead to some, maybe very small amount of increased effort on bobcat during that time. Is that correct, Chris, more or less?
I mean, if that's the case, and we're going to have all this, hopefully, new data because we're going to make effort mandatory, then I think it makes a really nice comparison between the present and the past.
I'm sorry, what makes a good comparison?
If all the effort is going to be required, if the bobcat goes through with just to keep the incidentals, then you'd actually be able to have a really nice comparison pre and post.
I see. Other comments? Yes, Teresa?
So to make sure I'm on the same ball page as everyone else, so the foothold traps are going to be eliminated during this, or we're going to have, because as of right now during fisher season, they're at 5 feet, and the other traps for bobcats are basically eliminated. And I know we have coyote traps.
Chris?
We were just talking bobcat trapping. Is that any kind of thing?
Let's look at
The petition is simply for the expansion of the season. It does not ask for any other changes. So that means the rules that require the conovers to be put up 5 feet after the close of the bobcat season, that would stay in place. And that would minimize additional harvest in that manner. Foothold traps for the open season during that extended portion would be able of taking cats. Does that right? There would be a lot of good taking cat with foothold trap during that extended season. Does that clarify it? I hope.
So the tools won't change, the methods won't change, your ability to keep the animal will change, and I suspect trapper effort will increase. You know, that's pretty much, they wouldn't go through all this this for just more, you know, for one or two animals. So trapper effort will increase. Any other questions? Yes?
I'm concerned with the 3-year sunset thing. I know how time slips by and 3 years turns into 3 years turns into a little longer and a little longer. So I'm not for a 3-year division. I would be more inclined to do a 1-week addition versus 2 and see, you know, instead of doing the 2-week extension, just do a 1-week extension and see how that works instead of doing a window of God knows how.
Okay. Okay. Yeah.
To me, the whole deal is to get rid of the incidentals. So if you just expand it a week, you're still going to have a week where you can get incidentals. So that's why I would say do it the whole 16 days, or 2 weeks, whatever.
I'm not even going down that kind of track at all. I mean, to me, it feels like because we don't have some of the data. I mean, when you had mentioned, you know, getting mandatory, you know, effort surveys, I mean, I was right there with that. It feels to me like in order to make the right decision based on the excellent report we have here, that we not only need a proposal in December for what the department's going to do to get that needed data, but then we need the results of that down the road. So, you know, to me, I mean, I'm willing, you know, we've already talked about the colony trap, you know, we'll talk about the otter, but, you know, at this point, based on what I heard, I mean, I'm personally not willing to consider the bobcat at all until we have a plan and then we have the results of that plan.
Appreciate saying that now rather than waiting until we go around. Well, seriously, that makes other people do it. Any other ideas? Okay. So, I'm not sure if you want to have two votes on the bobcat. One is a straight-up proposal as it was presented, and one with a 3-year sunset suggestion. Or if you want to, you know, Teresa's trying to break it up into a third category. I'm not sure what's your desire here.
Let's go around the original one. So we're in.
Okay. All right. This would be an extension of the bobcat season for the
next 2 weeks, last weeks, or the rest of December, I guess is how you say it.
That's right, yeah. So it's for the month of December.
For the month of December. So yes vote would be yes supporting the bobcat season extension for the month of December. This is a straw vote, of course.
Well, or is yes supporting the department's recommendation to oppose it?
The petition. Good clarification. So a yes would support the petition, and a no vote would just say no, I don't support the petition.
Supports it.
Everybody clear on that? And it'd be unfortunate if your home said, wait a minute. Yeah. All right. So a yes vote.
Say that one more time.
Sure. A yes vote will be a supportive vote of the petition as it was submitted to have bobcat season extended for the month of December. A no vote would be to deny the petition section on bobcat for the month of December and just maintain what we have. Okay. That makes a guess?
I'm unclear as to why we need a straw vote on this particular.
Well, if I could just speak to that briefly, Jim.
Thank you.
Because if you're giving guidance to the department on what you want us to come back to for a first vote on opening the rule. So you're giving us guidance about what you'd like to see us come back to you with.
Little mistakes like this colony trap thing, which no one intended to do what it did. We went back and forth on that. Could be avoided if they sit down on the table and say, well, how do we clarify this? You folks ready for the question? Okay.
Yes and no.
So Kevin, let's just make it clear. This is just a straw vote. It doesn't mean anything.
Yeah.
Except bringing up the topic.
Yeah. And if we have another vote on this, then we would have.
Then it will be.
If it passes, then we would have hearings and public comment and all that kind of stuff.
So this is just to bring it
up. Right.
So, the yes vote would be supporting the bobcat season extension throughout the month of December, and the no vote would be to deny that petition. Okay, let's go with that right now. Patrick?
No.
And Justin?
No.
Yes.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
No.
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 Feel your pain. Yes.
Yes.
Surprisingly enough, no.
And yes.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 no's is what I get. 6 yes, 7 no's is what I get.
Great. I have 6. And 7. Makes 13. Makes sense.
What did you vote
on? So, I have 7 no's and 6 yeses.
Yes, that's correct.
So that straw poll does fail to advance that petition on the bobcat. 7-6. Now, moving on to the otter season extension, which is moving it to... I'm sorry, what was that?
Do you want to give people an opportunity on the other bobcat versions, or do you feel like that's fine? I just don't know what's the pleasure of the board.
Thank you for interrupting. That's important. What do you think? Do we need to vote on that other provision of a 3-year sunset?
Yes.
Perhaps that's why some people would hold them back. Okay, I have one person saying yes. I think we'll go for it if that's okay with the board. It's late. Let's do it. So shall we have that bobcat petition accepted with the idea that the board would come back to us with a 3-year sunset provision? To evaluate the results. Yes vote would be yep, support the petition, and yes, have a 3-year study period. Okay, are you ready for that question?
I would hope that they would come back a year after and let us know what's going on, not after the 3 years.
Right.
But potentially it could end in 3 years.
The one caveat to that, just for informational purposes, we might not have enough data after 1 year to tell you what's going on.
But you would know all there was.
No, we could tell you the harvest numbers. Right. Yeah.
And it will be correlated with a new effort, right?
There you go. All right, so if you vote yes, you're supporting that bobcat petition with the idea that the department will come back in 3 years, identify.
No, me as well.
Thank you.
No.
No.
Yes.
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 Doesn't really matter what I think.
No.
Thank you.
I told you that before.
All right, so that does fail. Three yes votes. Regarding the otter petition, section of the petition there, which would extend the otter season, the yes is to allow that otter season extension throughout the month of March, and no vote would be to deny it. Any comments or suggestions? Or yes?
One quick point. So by not having to modify the triggers during beaver season, so you don't catch incidental otters, so they're going to be set, so it's basically it's a catch trap. Correct. It's a
killer set.
A killer set instead of partially sliding through, catching mid body, and then it might take a little bit. So.
Correct. And just for clarification, we think that's fairly rare, but yes.
Okay, so it's a kill set.
We would address that. Yeah.
Any other comments, questions?
Yes. So to that point, I found that a lot of the information really interesting about incidental take versus projected take. So if the incidental take right now is 5, Chris, is that right? Give or take, that's fine.
Yes.
And we also don't know what's not reported for an incidental. And the projected take with the extension would be somewhere between 3 to 11. It's really very similar. So you're talking about the same amount of take going from what you could argue would be a more humane set with the triggers. Not tonight, I'm sorry, but I want to hear about the triggers because I think there's a heck of an argument to be made that triggers in combination with the extension, you would have the same amount of take with a humane method of take with those triggers. So, I mean, I'm not prepared to vote until I hear about the second part of this, which isn't just the data, but also about the triggers, because I'm just not familiar with them. So you can take a straw poll, but I'll abstain until the next meeting or whenever it is, I can hear about that.
My belief is this trigger answer is a quick one. Is it?
I'm sorry, could you repeat that, please? Chris was...
He couldn't hear what you were saying, but I think he could respond to that tonight.
Okay, we don't need diagrams or anything like that.
I don't know. Ask the question again, just quickly.
No, I want to hear about the difference in the two types of sets between what is being proposed with the extension so that instead of having incidental take, which, you know, is probably considered less humane for otters, you would move towards taking the same amount of animals with a much more humane take. Because beaver season is not on the table. So assuming beaver season stays in place, you know, but I don't understand how the triggers work.
Page 39, does it? I'm just going to share a diagram with you.
We need to get the numbers straight. It might take me a second to drag.
Chris, for what it's worth, I don't need apples to apples. I mean, statistics.
The 5 that you have said has incidental take of otter is not just March. That's out of season. I think that is through the rest of the year. That's reported to us. So in March, it's being incidentally taken in March currently is on the magnitude of 2. I have to look it up. But I think
it's 1.
Yeah. Actually, I think that is correct. I want to confirm that, but it was a low number. It's very low. Actually, no way. It's
probably the public can't all see this. On page 39 in the digest is a diagram that has been there for many years that identifies that the trigger in March has to be offset. The distance between the edge of the trap and the trigger is 6 inches or 8 inches?
6 inches.
6 inches? So basically, you're sliding that trigger way over the side is the intent. Under proposal as suggested, this trigger rule would be moved to the center. The animal's going to go through it fast. Believe me, they go through it fast. And it'll be a killer set.
Is that for the entire season?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So my comment about it is it's incidental take. It doesn't matter whether it's in season or out of season. You can look it up, but go ahead.
So to get to your point, 5 again is total taken out of season August, September, July, and then in March, it varies from 0 to 1 since 2007.
It doesn't matter, because if you're talking about changing the trigger at the entire season,
right?
You know, it's still the same. So yeah, I got it.
Are there other questions?
Thank you. Curious, you're ready for this vote, huh?
Okay, straw vote. So yes vote would be allowing the petitioners petition to move forward, have the otter season for the entire month of March, along with what we already have, with a change in the trigger provision as well, which the department can define. It sounds like it would just go away. That would be the way it would be managed. Any questions about that? So yes would be support, no would be to deny it. Patrick, would you start?
Yes.
No.
Yes.
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 Yes. Yes. I'm all by myself again.
Does pass at 12 to 13.
A little ringer.
Commissioner, we're moving through our agenda here, right? Flying along here.
Are you copying that?
I have an update that will make it mercifully brief. Dead Creek Day, October 1. I'd love to see you there. If you can make it, no, you might not be able to. We did the first of our UVM seminars with graduate and undergraduate students to the Wildlife Society, very successful. 65 students came to see us. Well, not to see me, to see these guys. It was really great. We had a very productive meeting with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife, U.S. Forest Service, to talk about mutual management and to talk about some ways that we can promote some management activities that they're doing and talk about them in relationship to our goals. That was productive. Angela's permit results come out tomorrow. You can find them on the web tomorrow, or we'll mail postcards out to people. We had three hunt of a lifetime winners for kids there. And last but not least, the Colonel did a program with conservation officers and prosecutors from Africa that I'd just like him to briefly mention to you.
I just wanted you to know we were petitioned by the State Department to host 13 wardens, prosecutors, and jurists from Africa, Benin, numerous countries that I can't remember. But it's all in an effort to explore how the United States is handling our wildlife trafficking. It's fascinating. I didn't get a chance to ask them a lot of questions, but several of them are going to return and do a big game hunt with me. So if any of you want to talk about it, please approach me at any time. We can do it via email. But a fascinating group, and really took away a lot from how Vermont does things across Fish and Wildlife. Thanks.
And there's a Facebook post about it on our Facebook page as well. Finally, a personal privilege. I'm always proud of the process this board does and the department does. I think we have as open and public a process as anywhere in state government. It's even more open now. So thank all of you, thank the audience members, and really just make me proud to be a little part of what you do. Thanks.
Our trail cameras are full of information to our heads, you know. Is anyone who has something that they just got to save around to?
I've called in 3 bobcats turkey hunting.
Right on.
No. Not now, but
response to me.
I'm not as bad of a caller as you said.
How many turkeys you call?
Anybody else?
I just want to give kudos to the department for the Bear Day in August and the Deer Day we had at the shop. Great turnout, all kinds of fantastic emails. So keep them coming. People really like them.
Senators, David Robillard from Troy, used to get a possible client for my position. When I get off, I told him meetings were short. It's not the first thing I'm alive about, but anyway.
So yes,
Governor, I'd like to thank you. I think you did a good job.
Yes. Any other comments?
I saw a white pelican.
Whoa. Who's going to give me a ride to my car?
Yeah.